At the beginning of the story, a man was resting on his sword in the battlefield. The man looked around and found out that everyone there was dead. The man hears someone speak to him. He was annoyed to see this person because it was his enemy. The man's enemy is a giant called Ahiyuri. It came into the empire 20 days ago alongside two other giants. These giants brought destruction and chaos into the world for unknown reasons. The man asked him why he was still alive after destroying half of the empire. Ahiyuri told the man not to worry because he is going to die very soon. The man told Ahiyuri that the other giants are waiting for him to die. He told him that one of the giants was burnt alive by a red dragon while the other giant was sealed for eternity by a man called Lorehorn. Ahiyuri told the man not to be too proud because even though the other giants lost, they killed the people who defeated them, so there is currently no powerful person in the world who can challenge them. The man told Ahiyuri that he is still very strong and healthy. Ahiyuri told the man to not deceive himself. He told the man that he can feel his energy fading away. Ahiyuri was happy that the man was going to die very soon. He told the man that if he had discovered his talent early and worked hard, he would have been a great obstacle to them. The man told Ahiyuri that he knows he lived a messed up life, so Ahiyuri does not need to tell him. Ahiyuri told him to be proud of his achievement. He told him that no human could accomplish what he did, so he should enjoy his victory while he still can because their world will soon be buried by the starlight. After Ahiyuri said this, the man cut off his head. After cutting off his head, the man did his best to move forward on his way to his destination. He remembered all his friends who are soldiers just like him. After walking for a while, the man saw the dead bodies of his friends. He wondered why they had to die to protect their honor. He told them that they should have ran away and lived their lives. The man wondered why he was the only one that was able to fight the giants, because even the strongest swordsman in the empire was not able to hurt them. He believed that his friends would not have died if he had not been pushed to the front lines to lead the soldiers. While the man was thinking, he hears someone call out to him. He was shocked to hear this person's voice. He did his best to pull himself together and walk towards the voice he heard. When the man arrived at his destination, he was shocked to see that his grand commander was still alive. His grand commander, whose name is Adeshan, was alive, but she had lost her arm. Adeshan asked the man, whose name is Ronan, if he had successfully killed Ahiyuri. Ronan said he has. Adeshan was extremely happy to hear this, she even cried. Ronan decided to ask her for a favor. He asked her if she could take care of the soldiers' dead bodies. Ronan asked her for this favor because in the empire, the bodies of soldiers are usually burnt or abandoned. Adeshan was surprised that Ronan asked her for such a favor. She asked him why he could not just take care of the soldiers himself since he is feeling okay. Ronan spat out some blood and told Adeshan that he is dying. Adeshan asked Ronan what he would do if he survived his situation. Ronan told her that he would love to attend the academy. Adeshan was shocked. She asked him why he wanted to go to the academy. Ronan told her that Ahiyuri said something to him that made him wonder how different his life would have been if he went to the academy. But the main reason Ronan wanted to go to the academy was because his late sister's wish was to send him there. Ronan felt bad that he was not able to go, but he was happy that he would soon be reunited with his sister and the rest of the family. Adeshan was sad to hear this. She told Ronan not to lose hope because a search party will start looking for them after the rain stops. Ronan told her not to say such stupid things because he was sure that the rain was not going to stop anytime soon. While Ronan was talking, the rain stopped. He and Adeshan were very surprised to see this. While they were thinking of what to do, the ground began to shake. When Ronan looked around to see what happened, he saw a being that looked like the giants in the sky. The being possessed 8 wings and it had an odd body. Alongside the mysterious being were more than 100 creatures that looked like it. Adeshan could not believe what she was looking at. She assumed that the war would be over once they defeated the 3 giants. She began to shake and lose hope. While she was lost in thought, Ronan shouted her name. He told her that she should use her telekinesis to push him up so he can fight against the creatures. Adeshan was surprised to hear this. She could not believe that Ronan still wanted to fight in their situation. Ronan brought out his sword and said he is not going to give up until he is dead. Adeshan was shocked to see that Ronan had not given up. She believed that Ronan could fight against this monsters. She stood up and moved close to Ronan. She moved close to his mouth and put a blue ball inside. Ronan asked her what she put in his mouth. She moved close to his ear and whispered something to him. After saying what she wanted to say, she begged Ronan to tell her to become a tailor if they meet again. She told him that she has done a lot of things but she loves being a tailor. Immediately after she said this, the creature with eight wings used a mysterious energy to kill them. When Ronan woke up, he called out Adeshan's name but he did not get any response. When he looked around, he realized that he was back to the village he spent his childhood in. He could not believe that he had returned to the past. After returning to the past, Ronan sat down to rationally think of his situation. He remembered that after Adeshan put the blue ball in his mouth, she told him that it is an orb that allows someone to travel to the past. It is thanks to this orb that Adeshan, a normal tailor, was able to become the Grand Commander. Adeshan told Ronan that the orb allows anyone to travel to the past four times, but she has used the orb three times, so there is only one chance left. She told Ronan that he has the ability to fight the giants, so he has a better chance of stopping the giants' attack and saving humanity. Adeshan told him that when he returns to the past, he has to improve his ability. She asked him to attend Phil Leon Academy because it is known for producing outstanding people. She begged him to tell her that she should become a tailor. She said that she has done a lot of things before but none of them gave her more joy than being a tailor. After she said this, they were killed. After remembering everything, Ronan still was not sure if he was dreaming. He began to shout and hit a tree. He wondered how he could change the future if he is alone in the past. While hitting the tree, Ronan realized that he is in the past, which meant that his sister is still alive. He picked up a stick and began to run home. While running through the town, he saw some people bullying a boy. What he did not understand was how the bullies were able to hold the boy on the tree upside down without touching him. He realized that the boy was held upside down with magic. He could not believe what he saw because anyone who could use magic was rarely seen on the battlefield, and yet there was someone like that in the village. At that moment he realized that a particular magician was actually here in the past. The person that was using the magic on the boy felt bad for what he was doing. The boy that was being bullied told the bully that he does not have any money. The boy said that the money he has is for his mother's medicine. The bully told the boy that he does not care about his mother's health. He began to slap and yell at him to bring out more money. The bully told the magician whose name is Asel to raise the boy to the top of the tree. Asel said that he can't raise the boy to the top of the tree because if he makes a mistake, the boy can fall and die. The bully told Asel that he will put him on tree if he disobey him. Asel was terrified to hear this. He did not know why such a thing was happening to him. He learnt magic because he wanted to show people that he is also good at something. He was very scared and did not know what to do. While he was thinking of what to do, Ronan used his wooden stick to hit him. Immediately Ronan hit him, Asel lost control and the boy fell to the ground. Ronan told him to stop because he might accidentally kill the boy. The bully was angry that Asel stopped. He asked Asel why he would disrespect him. Asel was about to reply but Ronan interrupted him. He asked Asel where he learnt telekinesis magic from. Asel told him that he learnt it from a grimoire he bought from a peddler. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He could not believe that Asel was already quite good even though he learnt from a cheap grimoire. The bully got angry that Ronan and Asel were ignoring him. He brought out his sword and rushed to attack Ronan. Ronan wondered where a boy like him could get a real sword. He was disappointed to see the bully rush to attack him because his posture was bad. He easily dodged the attack. The bully was shocked to see this. This was not very shocking to Ronan because even if he returned back to the past, the battle sense which was instilled in him as a soldier will always be with him. The bully told Ronan that he was lucky to dodge his attack. He told him to get on his knees and beg for his life while he still can. He told him that he is going to kill him and take care of his sister. Ronan was shocked when he heard the bully mention his sister. The bully said that he has always dreamt of sleeping with Ronan's sister. When Ronan heard this, he used his wooden sword to remove the bully's ear. The boy screamed in pain. Ronan moved close to him and told him not to mention his sister's name unless he wants to die. The other bullies could not believe what they saw. Ronan was using the same wooden stick just like them, and yet he was able to cut someone's ear off. Ronan told them to leave the money they stole from the boy they bullied and to drop some extra cash for ruining his mood. After collecting the money, Ronan gave it to the boy. The boy told Ronan that the money he received is more than what they took from him. Ronan told the boy that all he wants is the sword and he has no need for the money. While the boy was thanking Ronan for what he had done, Asel pulled himself together and apologized to the boy. He said that he was very scared of the bully, so he had no choice but to do what he wanted. The boy told Asel to not apologize. He understood that Asel was being threatened by the bully. After thanking Ronan, the boy left. Ronan was happy that Asel was not a bully. He told Asel that he has something he wants to do with him, so Asel is to meet him in 4 days' time. He told Asel not to run away, because if he finds him, he will beat him up. After saying this to Asel, Ronan ran to his house. When he arrived there, he picked some flowers for his sister because she loves them a lot. He decided to throw the flowers away because he thought that it was a little stupid. As he was about to walk away, he hears his sister come out of the house. When Ronan was a soldier, he always thought about what he would do if he ever meets his sister again. He wondered if he should have apologized for leaving her or if he should tell her that he missed her. The only thing Ronan could do when he saw her was smile. When Ronan entered the house, his elder sister Iril was admiring the flowers he got for her. She cooked Ronan a lot of food to show her appreciation. After eating, Ronan asked his sister how old she is this year. Iril said that she is 22 years old. Ronan was happy to hear this, because if his sister is 22, that means he has 10 years to prepare to fight the mysterious creatures. Iril was shocked that Ronan asked her for her age. She touched his head to check if he is sick. Ronan was happy that he had such a sweet and kind sister. He decided to do anything to protect her. Ronan told his sister that he wants to attend an academy. Iril was happy to hear this. She asked Ronan if he was joking, because she had always wanted him to go to an academy, but he always declined her offer. Ronan said he is serious about it. After Iril heard this, she searched the house and brought out a huge pot. When Ronan looked inside the pot, he saw a lot of money there. Ronan asked Iril why she has such a large amount of money. Iril said that she has been saving her money in secret so that she would be able to afford sending Ronan to an academy. Ronan thanked Iril for her support. He told her that the money she has won't be enough to enroll him in the academy he wants to attend. Iril asked Ronan which academy does he want to attend. Ronan said he wants to attend the Phil Leon Academy. Iril was surprised to hear this. She screamed in disbelief. Phil Leon Academy is an academy that represents the Empire. It is the best educational institution in the Empire. It has the most outstanding professors in the continent, and it is funded by the Imperial family. It is prestigious enough to be called the Factory of Heroes. It produced many amazing people like Grand Commander Adeshan, Swordmaster Shulafen, and the Winter Witch. The academy is very hard to get into. Even Iril was not sure if Ronan was good enough to attend. After walking for a while, Ronan reached his destination. When he got there, he was surprised to see that Asel actually came to meet him. Ronan told Asel that he wants to check something important with him. He told Asel to use his telekinesis to lift him up. Asel was shocked that Ronan would ask him for such a strange request. He told Ronan that he does not want to do such a dangerous thing. Ronan told him not to worry and do as he is told. Asel used telekinesis to raise Ronan up. Ronan was shocked by how high Asel could take him. While Asel's magic was not as strong as the magic used on Ronan when he fought Ahiyuti, Ronan knew that Asel's telekinesis is important, because it was what allowed him to fight Ahiyuti on equal grounds. He knew that telekinesis is a rare magic that most mages do not have, so he considered Asel to be the most important element in his fight against the giants. After holding Ronan up for a while, Asel began to lose control. Ronan told him to hold on for a minute because he wants to test something. He brought out his sword and swung it in the air. Immediately he did this, he landed on the ground. Asel was shocked to see this, because he did not lose control and yet Ronan landed on the ground. He was surprised that Ronan cut his magical energy called mana. Asel asked Ronan how he was able to do it. Ronan hit Asel's head and told him not to ask about it. Even when Ronan was a soldier, he did not know how he was able to do things. He aims to understand his ability better in this life. After putting his sword away, Ronan gave Asel his bag and told him to follow him because he is about to do something that is going to be on the first page of his biography, which he calls the Empire's History Book. On the way to their destination, Ronan told Asel that he is going to be joining him in Phil Leon Academy. Asel was surprised to hear this because he knew that Ronan was a martial arts genius, but he did not see himself as someone who is talented enough to attend Phil Leon Academy. Ronan asked Asel if he wants to waste his life and talent in this village. He told Asel that he is a coward and a loser. He told him that he will regret wasting his time in this village. Ronan knew the feeling of wasting one's life because he did the same when he was a soldier. Asel was very happy to hear Ronan say this. He believed that Ronan cared so much about him. He told Ronan that he will go to Phil Leon Academy. Ronan congratulated him for making a manly decision. He told Asel that he has to clear his first hurdle to prove he is a real man. When Ronan and Asel arrived at their destination, Asel was surprised that his first hurdle was to defeat a lunar goblin. Ronan told Asel that it is a task that fits him perfectly. Asel understood that Ronan is a crazy person. A lunar goblin is a type of goblin that often appears around that area. Most people differentiate them from normal goblins by their yellow skin and disfigured bodies, but their main characteristic is that they go crazy over gold and other treasures. They gather all the goods they stole and have a festival on a night with a full moon. Ronan told Asel that the reason he brought them there on this night is to steal the treasures from the goblins. Asel was shocked that Ronan knew that the goblins steal treasures and have a festival on a night with a full moon. Ronan told him that he read it in a book. This was a lie. Ronan got this information in his past life. Ronan told Asel that he needs to use his telekinesis to take all the treasures and put it into his bag. Asel told Ronan that he is scared of doing this because if he makes a mistake and wakes the goblin, he and Ronan could be killed. Ronan told Asel that if they want to get into Phil Leon Academy, they need two things. The first is money. They need a lot of money to pay for the crazy tuition fees. The second thing they need is real life experience. While money is important, having real life experience is more crucial. Phil Leon Academy is a place that is filled with aristocrats who have received elite training from birth, and the only way to even dream about winning people like that is to gain experience by risking one's life. That is why the lunar goblins are perfect, because they will give them both money and experience. When Asel heard this, he was sad because what Ronan said actually made sense. After calming down, Asel began to use his telekinesis to steal the treasures. He was very careful and focused on what he was doing. After Ronan filled the bags, he thanked Asel for his efforts. He was not actually sure if Asel could do what he asked, so he was surprised when it went as planned. Ronan was very happy that he found a useful slave. When Ronan was packing his bag up, two men were chasing after a bird. They screamed at the bird in anger. Unfortunately for Ronan, a goblin woke up thanks to the scream. When the goblin looked around, it noticed that their treasures were gone. It immediately woke the other goblins and explained their situation. While Ronan and Asel were about to run, the goblins saw them. They rushed to attack them. Asel fell on his knees out of fear. He asked Ronan if they should abandon the treasure and run. Ronan told him to hold on to the treasure because they need it for their tuition. As the goblins were moving close to them, Ronan brought out his sword to check its weight and its hardness. He knew that with the quality of the sword he had, he could only attack 15 times before the sword becomes useless. This was an issue because there are 30 goblins, but Ronan believed that 15 attacks would be enough. When he first swung his sword, he cut the heads of 3 goblins. Asel could not believe what he saw. Ronan killed the first 3 goblins in one strike, then he attacked the other goblins at a crazy speed that made him look like he disappeared. After handling the goblins, Ronan told Asel to get up because they need to return home. On their way home, Ronan felt some pain in his shoulders. He could not believe that his muscles would be sore after he sliced some goblins. He realized that it is probably because his body is still growing. he decided that he needs to do a lot of physical training when he returns to his house. Asel asked Ronan who he thinks made the loud noise that woke the goblins. Ronan said that he does not know who it is, but he will beat up the person if he ever meets them. While Ronan and Asel were walking, someone shot an arrow at Asel. Luckily for Asel, Ronan caught the arrow. Asel was surprised to see this. He wondered where the arrow came from. While he and Ronan were discussing, the two men who screamed at the bird and tried to shoot Asel came to meet them. They apologized for shooting at them. They asked them what children like them were doing there at night. Ronan was very angry that they called him a child. They looked at Ronan's bag and saw the treasures. They were happy to see this. They apologized to Ronan and Asel again. Ronan told them to stop their fake apologies. He asked them who they are. The man brought out a knife and attacked Ronan. He told Ronan that their group's name is Caliboro. When Ronan heard the name of their group, he took the knife away from the man and used it to stab him. When the man's friend saw this, he rushed to attack Ronan, but he is stopped by Asel, who uses a skill called Invisible Hand to hold him down. Ronan thanked Asel for saving him. He took the man's knife and used it to tear him apart. Asel was shocked to see this. He asked Ronan if he killed the man. Ronan told him that he will kill anyone that tries to kill him. He said that this man deserved what they got because the group which this people belong to is responsible for a lot of evil. They commit crimes like poaching, kidnapping, and human trafficking. They are known as the Empire's worst poaching group. Ronan told Asel that this men were going to steal their treasures and harvest their organs. While clearing the bodies, Ronan and Asel see the men's bag move. When they opened it, a bird came out of it. Ronan was shocked to see the bird because it had blue feathers. When he looked at the bird's legs, he saw a chain on it. The chain is an equipment used by Caliboro to disrupt a prisoner's mana and restrict their movement. Ronan was surprised that Caliboro would use such an equipment because it is only used to capture mystical beasts. While thinking, Ronan sees a magic circle at the back of the bird and hears the bird speak. Asel was surprised to see this. He assumed that the bird could actually speak. Ronan told him that someone is speaking to them through communication magic. Ronan was shocked that the communication magic worked immediately. The bird came out of the bag. This means that the person speaking has been trying to connect to the bird, but the bag was blocking the connection. The person whose name is Varen is a professor who is researching about mystical beast. Varen said that he is the guardian of the bird whose name is Marpez. Varen said that he was not able to connect to Marpez for a while and he was just about to report to the authorities. He asked Ronan and Asel who they were. Ronan said that they are righteous passers-by. He said that they saved Marpez from poachers. Varen could not believe that Marpez was kidnapped. He thanked Ronan for saving Marpez and asked them how he can repay them. Asel told Varen not to worry about repaying them. He asked Varen how Marpez is going to return back to him because he looks exhausted from being chained up. Ronan asked Varen if Marpez will be able to fly well once he cuts the chain. Varen said that he will. After Varen said this, Ronan broke Marpez's chains in one strike. He told Marpez to return home. When Marpez heard this, he saw Ronan as a shining hero. He shoved his ass in Ronan's face. Varen told Ronan that Marpez wants to see him again and because of this he wants him to pluck one of his feathers. He told Ronan that a dream bird like Marpez can use its feather as a compass to the main body. He told Ronan that he will repay him when he comes to his institution. After saying this, Marpez flew away. After Marpez flew away, Ronan saw something on his hand. A few days later, Ronan took the treasures he obtained to a merchant called Down Carabel. Down is the owner of the Carabel Merchantry. Down was happy to meet a customer like Ronan because he brought a lot of valuable things. Ronan was also happy to meet a merchant like Down because he appreciated the items he brought. The other merchants were doing their best to scam Ronan, but Down was honest with him. Ronan asked Down if he could help him appraise an item. Ronan brought out an odd-looking egg and gave it to Down. Ronan first thought that the egg was poop. He was angry that Marpez would do such a thing to him. He threw the egg on a boulder. The egg completely crushed the boulder. That is why Ronan wants to know what type of egg it is. After taking a close look at the egg, Down thought that the egg was horse poop. Ronan was surprised to hear this. he took the egg from the man and decided to keep it for later. Ronan asked Down if he sold books about Phil Leon Academy. He told Down that they are applying to Phil Leon Academy and they need books to read. Down was happy to hear this because his daughter is also applying to the academy. He introduced them to his daughter Maria. Ronan was surprised to see Maria. Down told Maria that Ronan and Asel are important people who he just closed a deal with. Maria was surprised to hear this. She could not believe that kids like them just made a deal with her father. Down apologized to Ronan and Asel that his daughter called them kids. Ronan walked up to Maria. He asked her if her middle name is Sen. Maria said that it is. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He could not believe that Maria looked so similar to someone he knew in his past life. Ronan was confused because the Maria he knew was a man. He moved close to Maria's ear and asked her if she has a penis. Maria was shocked that Ronan would ask her such a question. She slapped his face with a lot of strength. When Ronan felt the slap, he was sure that the only person that could slap him like this is his own Maria. In his past life, Ronan worked as a disciplinary soldier in a place called Armelin. The Maria he knew was in charge of supplies at Armelin. Maria was an easygoing person who got along with everyone, but when the soldiers talk about penis, Maria always got angry and always slapped the people around her. Ronan had always been curious about why Maria behaved like that. He wanted to ask Maria about the issue, but he never got the chance because Maria died. Ronan was happy to find out that the reason Maria always acted like that was because she is a girl. Maria thought that Ronan was laughing at her. She decided to hit him again, but Ronan stopped her attack and he hit her on her head and told her not to hit him again. He told her that he only allowed her to hit him because he asked a foolish question. Maria was annoyed to hear this. She used her head to hit Ronan's chin. Immediately she did this, she and Ronan began to fight. After they calmed down, Ronan and Maria began to talk like they were friends. Asel was shocked to see this. He thought that they were insane. Maria brought a sword called the Black Iron Sword. She told Ronan that the Black Iron Sword is an amazing sword that even knights want to buy. Ronan told her that he fights in a rough manner and so he needs a sword that does not break easily. Maria assured him that the Black Iron Sword is the best for him. Ronan was happy to receive the sword because it was the same one he used in his past life. After giving Ronan his weapon, she asked Asel what kind of magic does he use. Asel told her that he uses telekinesis. Maria was shocked to hear this. She told Asel that if he performs well on his test, he could be given a scholarship. Asel was very happy to hear this. Maria was sure that she did not need to worry about Asel. She decided to focus on Ronan. She asked him about the technique he is going to present to the judges on the day of the test. She told Ronan that if he wants to enter Phil Leon Academy, he needs to impress the judges with an amazing technique. The school also has a written exam which is difficult, but it is not as difficult as the practical one. The practical exam is very important to the extent that if one performs well in it, they could still enter the academy even if they have a low grade in the written exam. Ronan asked Maria about the technique he needs to demonstrate. Maria told him that most nobles usually demonstrate their family's secret techniques, but normal martial arts applicant usually demonstrate their personal mana fighting techniques. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He asked Maria if it is possible for martial artists to use mana even though they are not mages. Maria was shocked to hear this question. She told Ronan that anyone who wants to join Phil Leon Academy would have to have been able to sense their own mana and be able to use that mana in combat. She believed that this information was known by everyone, and yet Ronan was looking at her like she was crazy. Ronan asked her if sensing mana is similar to sensing aura. Maria was shocked to hear this. She could not believe that someone like Ronan wanted to enter Phil Leon Academy. Ronan told her not to worry. He said that it might be something he already knows. Maria stood up and asked Ronan to join her outside. She took two short swords that belonged to Ronan. Ronan asked her to leave the swords. He asked her what she would do if she damages them. Maria told him that she will give him triple the money he used to buy the swords. She told him to get up immediately because she wants to give him some special training. Mana is the source of the power of nature. It is a natural energy that exists everywhere in the world, but not everyone can use it. In order to use it, one has to sense and feel their own energy and be able to use mana sense. To enter this stage, one has to go through various trainings and understand themselves better. It usually takes a year for a normal person to get mana sense. After they practice their mana techniques and they have perfected them, they apply to Phil Leon Academy. Maria told Ronan that the fact that he does not know the difference between aura and mana proves that he is not yet ready to attend Phil Leon Academy. She told Ronan that aura is a type of mana. Even people who are quite talented in using mana train for at least 10 years to achieve aura. Ronan remembered meeting people who could use aura on the battlefield. They often bragged about it and they used an unusual power. But this did not matter to Ronan because most of them ended up dead. Maria told Ronan that she is no longer explaining. She brought out her sword and rushed to attack Ronan. Ronan blocked the attack. He was shocked by her strength. He was surprised to see how skilled she was and how she was able to fight him well with dual blades. Although Ronan could not see if she was using mana, but he could tell that she was using it to fight him. Maria was impressed with Ronan. She originally wanted to defeat Ronan in one round in order to show him the use of mana and make him give up the test on his own. She wanted Ronan to give up because she did not want him to be humiliated at the academy, but to her surprise, Ronan was much stronger than she expected. She could not believe that he did not know how to use mana. While Maria was lost in thought, Ronan used his sword to push her away. He took a deadly stance and told her to dodge his attack. Fortunately for Maria, she listened to Ronan and dodged the attack. After successfully dodging the attack, she told Ronan that he is not a normal person. Ronan told her that she is also quite good. He told her that she is very talented in using her blades, but she is still clumsy in finding her center of balance. He told her that if she can fix this problem, she will improve a lot. After saying this, Ronan put his sword away and turned around. Maria was angry to see this. She told him that the fight is not over and he needs to continue. Ronan told her that she should not forget that she promised to triple his money. Immediately he said this, Maria's dual blades broke. Maria was extremely shocked to see this. Asel told her not to worry, like he never expected her to win Ronan. After saying this, he left with Ronan. Maria could not believe what had just happened to her. She was sure that Ronan is not a human being. The next day, Maria gave Ronan and Asel some books and some materials. She told them that these are books which she personally summarized. Ronan asked her what they are for. Maria was surprised to hear this. She told Ronan that he and Asel need the books because the test is in a month's time. Ronan told her that the books are too much. He brought out his sword and asked her if she is trying to rip him off. Maria told Ronan that she is giving them because she has come to like them and she wishes that they can enter Phil Leon Academy together. She also told him that the books are free. Immediately Ronan heard this, he put his sword away. She told him that she would love to teach them herself, but their group has to move away to another place. She told them to work hard and study a lot so she can see them at the academy. Ronan told her not to worry and focus on herself. After saying this to her, Maria got on the carriage. She told them that she will see them on the test day and they should not lose her books. After Maria left, Ronan noticed that his body was sore from the spar he had with Maria. He knew that it was urgent that he trains his weakened body. He found it funny that he also has to study and work hard to get into an academy. He thought of his situation as an odd one, but he did not hate it. After Ronan returned home, he began to live differently. He ate a lot of food and he hunted monsters constantly in order for him to get used to his body and increase his stamina. He eventually killed all the monsters in the village. At night, Ronan did his best to study. He never imagined he would do something like this in his past life. Ronan continued this routine until a month passed and it was finally the day for the test. When Asel saw Phil Leon Academy, he could not believe that such a structure existed because the academy was like a mini city. Ronan told him to stop staring because he looks like a country bumpkin. Asel was about to apologize when he noticed something about Ronan. He told Ronan that his body has gotten bigger in just a month. Ronan told him to not focus on stupid things like that. Instead, he should enter the academy for the test. While walking, Ronan realized that someone important would also be partaking in this test. That person is the Sword Saint Shulafen, the strongest man in the empire. he is representing the renowned swordsmanship clan called Grangxia. Ronan is sure that he will meet him because Shelafen is the same age as him and so he should be taking the test too. While Ronan was thinking, Asel asked him if he has the feather which he plucked from the dream bird. Ronan brought out the feather when he remembered that Varen's institution was in the capital. When he brought out the feather, he noticed that it was pointing to a tall building in Phil Leon Academy. At the top of the tall building, Marpez and Varen Fanasir, who is the Academy's zoology professor, was rearranging his office in order to prepare to greet Ronan. Varen is a werelion. Varen decided to open the window in order to let some air in. Immediately he opened the window, he saw Ronan's creepy face. When he and Marpez saw this, they screamed. Varen asked Ronan how he got to his window because his office is on the top floor of the building. He asked them if they are after Marpez. Ronan brought out the feather to show Varen. Varen was surprised to see it. He realized that Ronan and Asel were the people who saved Marpez. Varen apologized for screaming at them. Ronan told him not to worry about it. He said that it is Asel's fault that they used the window. Asel was surprised to hear this. He told Varen that the reason they entered through the window was because Ronan said he was too tired to use the stairs, so he asked him to use telekinesis to raise him up. Ronan squeezed Asel's mouth to stop him from confessing the truth. He told Varen that he is surprised that he is a werelion and a professor of Phil Leon Academy. Varen said that he is also surprised that Ronan and Asel are applicants of the academy. He felt bad that he did not know because he could have written a recommendation letter that would allow them to enter the academy without taking any test. Ronan told Varen not to worry about them. He told Varen that he wants him to help him look at something. He brought out the egg which Marpez laid. Varen was very surprised to see this. Ronan asked him why he is surprised that a bird laid an egg. Varen said that the egg that a dream bird lays is different from a normal egg. He said that he does not know what will hatch out of the egg. Ronan was surprised to hear this. Varen told him that depending on the environment the dream bird is in, it will absorb unique mana and lay an egg. In an area that is filled with lava, a phoenix will hatch out of the egg. In a monster's nest, the hatched dream bird will look like the monster, and in some circumstances, the hatched dream bird will not take the shape of a bird. Varen said that if he analyzes the mana of the dream bird, he can guess what will hatch out of it, but he cannot really tell what it is at the moment. Ronan was annoyed to hear this. He could not believe that an egg could be stressful to understand. He wondered what place Marpez was in for him to lay such an egg. Varen told Ronan that he wants him to look after the egg. Ronan asked him if it was okay because the egg is quite precious. Varen told Ronan that a dream bird only lays an egg once in a lifetime. The fact that Marpez laid an egg in front of Ronan means that he felt something special in Ronan. Ronan accepted Varen's request because he was also curious about what kind of thing that will hatch out of the egg. Ronan and Asel decided to leave because their test was going to start very soon. Varen told them to wait for him. He brought out a map and told Ronan that it will help them in hatching the egg. After receiving the map, Ronan and Asel went to take their test. At the Galleon Castle where the test was taking place, the martial arts applicants all gathered in one place. An attendant comes out from a room and asked applicant 112 to enter. Ronan realized that after applicant 112, he is next. He had already gotten tired from waiting. Maria told him that all tests are like this. He asked Maria, who was sitting next to him, what she was wearing. Maria told him that Phil Leon Academy is an institution which all nobles attend. She said that she wants to present herself well in case they become her customers in future. While Ronan and Maria were discussing, applicant 112 came out of the room, and applicant 113, which is Ronan, was asked to step in. Maria told Ronan to not be nervous. She told him to do his best. Ronan told her not to worry because nothing is going to happen. When Ronan stepped in, he was shocked by the air around the professors. Each one of them was extraordinary, especially the old man in the middle, who is the academy's headmaster and an archmage. His name is Krava Kratir. Ronan was also shocked by the energy the swordsmanship instructor possessed. This woman's name is Nabiros, and she is called the Grand Sword Saint. After Ronan introduced himself, he was asked to fight a magically engineered dummy. They asked about the technique he is going to show them. Ronan told them that he is only going to use a fast cut. The professors were shocked that Ronan was going to use a simple cut without any mana. They thought he was an idiot because the dummy had enough defensive ability to block an aura user and it has a very fast regeneration ability. The professors believed Ronan was stupid because even Shulafen was barely able to scratch the dummy. Krava could not believe that the professors were being rude to Ronan in front of him. He decided to ignore them. When he looked at Ronan, he was shocked. He could not believe that someone could possess such vigor at a young age. The moment Ronan unsheathed his sword, he slashed the dummy. Nabiros was surprised to see this. After the attack, Ronan put his sword away. The professors laughed at Ronan. They could not believe that he only showed them one cut. One of the professors asked Krava how he wanted to grade Ronan, but Krava was not listening because he was shocked by what Ronan did. While Krava was looking at Ronan, Nabiros picked up her sword and attacked Ronan. She asked him where he learned his swordsmanship. Ronan told her that he cannot answer the question. She decided to change her question. She asked him if he saw how she attacked him. Ronan told her that she unsheathed her sword at a crazy speed and she swung her sword 3 times despite the distance between them. Nabiros said that she swung her sword 3 times to show Ronan that his fast cut was arrogant. She told him that she noticed that he made his cut slow so that the professors could see what he had done. She was angry to see this because she considered it to be insulting to the professors. The other professors could not even tell if Ronan slowed the attack. They were very confused. Ronan was surprised to hear what Nabiros said. The only reason he made his cut slower was because he was not sure if his sword could withstand the last attack. Ronan was not sure if he should explain himself considering how angry Nabiros was. After calming down, Nabiros put her sword away. She told Ronan that she will be the one to teach him. Krava was shocked that Nabiros already accepted Ronan as her student. He thanked Ronan for his demonstration and asked him why he came to their academy. Ronan thought about what happened in the past and told Krava that he does not want to have any regrets. Krava was very shocked to hear this. He asked Ronan to step out after hearing his answer. Krava was surprised to hear Ronan's answer. He said that he also wants to teach Ronan. One of the professors was shocked to hear this. He asked Krava what is special about Ronan. Krava said that Ronan has talent. Immediately he said this, the magically engineered dummy that was said to have fast regeneration lost its head. The two professors who mocked Ronan were extremely shocked to see this. After Ronan left the room, he wondered if he could have won against Nabiros in his past life. Ronan knew that he has to work extra hard if he wants to catch up to Nabiros. He was happy that he came to Phil Leon Academy because he could learn a lot of things here. After finishing the practical test, people are expected to write their theory exam. Ronan had been studying for a month, so he believed it would be easy. Unfortunately, this was not true. When Ronan came out of the test center, he was shaking in fear. Maria was shocked to find out that Ronan was not able to answer even half of the test. She surprised to hear this because she told Ronan to read the books in the bag. Acel told Maria that Ronan forgot to check the books and materials. Maria told Ronan not to worry because she is sure that he did well in his practical test and he will be accepted by the academy. Immediately she said this, a blue tablet appeared in the middle of the place they were in. The students went to look at the tablet because it contained their results. Acel got first place in the theory exam and he got 12th position in the practical exam of the magic department. Maria took 9th place in the theory exam and she got 9th place in practical exam of the martial arts department. Acel and Maria began to rejoice when they saw their results. Maria was shocked that Acel took first place in the theory exam. She congratulated him. While they were rejoicing, Maria asked Ronan what results did he get. Ronan told her that his result is not there. Maria was surprised to hear this. She told Ronan to stop joking. As Ronan was about to lose hope, an explosion occurred close to them. When they looked at what caused the explosion, it turned out to be a phoenix called the Glory Phoenix. It is a bird that usually appears to call out the salutatorian of each department. The phoenix shot a fireball at Ronan. When the fireball came close to Ronan, it revealed to Ronan that he got first place in the practical exam and he took the 5712th position in the theory exam, and because of this, he is the salutatorian of the martial arts department. Asel and Maria began to rejoice when they saw this. Ronan was also very happy with the result. Maria could not believe that he is the salutatorian despite his position in the theory exam. While they were rejoicing, Ronan realized that the fact that he took first place in the practical exam means that he stole it from someone very important. When Ronan looked back, a boy was walking towards him. The boy could not believe that Ronan took first place in the practical exam. This boy was the person that was supposed to be first place in the practical exam if Ronan had not shown up. This boy is the sword Saint Shulafen. Ronan was surprised to see Shulafen. Maria believed that Shulafen wanted to talk to Ronan, but Ronan knew that Shulafen was not like that. Ronan was annoyed to see Shulafen because he knew that he would cause trouble for him. In Ronan's past life, Shulafen was a person who did not like the idea of anyone being better than him at swordsmanship. Ronan knew that he had to avoid Shulafen at all cost. He told Shulafen that he is also shocked that he is first in the practical exam. Shulafen did not believe Ronan. He asked Ronan why he was lying. Ronan said that he is speaking the truth. He told Shulafen that he does not have any proof that he is lying. He asked him to leave him alone. Shulafen knew that Ronan was right. He decided to attack Ronan to get his proof. Ronan successfully blocked the attack with his sword. Asel and Maria were surprised to see this. Shulafen told Ronan that he would not be able to block his attack if he was not first in the practical exam. He told Ronan to show him his skills because he wanted to see what made him get second in the practical exam. Ronan was annoyed to hear this. He decided to attack Shulafen seriously. He created three slashes in one attack. Shulafen successfully blocked the attack. After blocking Ronan's attack, Shulafen's hand began to shake. He told Ronan that he understands why he was given such an amazing grade, but he did not believe that the technique Ronan displayed was enough to beat him. He attacked Ronan again. He told Ronan to show him everything he can do. Ronan was annoyed to hear this. He could not believe that there could be someone as crazy as Shulafen. Shulafen told Ronan that he cannot accept the results of the practical exam. He began to attack Ronan at a crazy speed, but Ronan was strong enough to block the attacks. While Ronan was blocking the attacks, he realized that things could turn out really bad for him because of how intense the fight was. He was scared that Shulafen would soon start using his aura. Ronan knew how powerful Shulafen's aura is because he had seen it in his past life. It was an extremely powerful aura known as the Tempest Sword. After realizing how bad the situation was, Ronan stopped fighting and began to run. Shulafen was shocked to see this. He told Ronan that he should never turn his back on his opponent in a fight. He decided to chase after Ronan. He was about to attack Ronan, but Ronan used a cell as a shield. Shulafen was surprised to see this. He told Ronan that he is a coward for hiding at the back of a woman. Asel told Shulafen that he is actually a man. Ronan knew that Shulafen would not attack an helpless woman because he is a proper gentleman. While hiding at Asel's back, Ronan used his sword to attack Shulafen's nose. Shulafen was really hurt by the attack. Ronan told Maria and Asel to run. Shulafen tried to stop them, but they had already gotten far away from him. Immediately after they left, an instructor of the academy came to see why the students gathered. The instructor was surprised to see Shulafen resting on his sword with an injured nose. He referred to Shulafen as Sir Shulafen. He asked him to give him the names of the students who harmed him. Shulafen told the instructor to speak to him informally because he is an applicant that is to be treated as a commoner. Shulafen told the instructor to not worry because the fight he had was a fair match. After getting up and regaining his strength, Shulafen noticed that his sword had cracked. He was surprised to see this because his sword is made from the strongest iron called mithril. Shulafen did not understand how his sword broke because he did not see Ronan's techniques as anything extraordinary. He could not believe what happened to him. He decided that he needs to remember Ronan. The next day, Ronan and Asel went to Shimo Forest, which is at the outskirts of the capital. Asel asked Ronan if they should be searching the forest right now. He told Ronan that Shelafen is the son of a ducal family and his family is the second most powerful family after the imperial family. He told Ronan that he has to be careful in case Shelafen decides to attack him. Ronan told Asel that while Shelafen is crazy about swords, he is actually a good person. In Ronan's past life, Shelafen was known as everyone's role model who protects the weak. Ronan knew him as the perfect noble. Ronan told Asel that Shelafen probably told people that he had a fair match with him because if Shelafen wanted to punish them, he and Asel would already be imprisoned. After searching for a while, Ronan and Asel found the location which Varen showed them on the map. This place is Fernando Spring and it has a mana vein. Mana that hovers around the world usually comes together for an unknown reason and gathers in a single spot to form a puddle called mana vein. Mana is usually absorbed from it by the surrounding matter. A regular rock would turn into the highest grade mana stone and a normal plant can turn into a miraculous herb. Ronan knows that the value of a mana vein is crazy. Most people would want to monopolize it for themselves. Yet Varen gave it to them for free in order to hatch the egg. Ronan asked Asel if this place feels different. Asel said that he has never felt so much mana before. He said that he can cast spells that are much stronger than usual. While looking at the mana vein, Asel noticed that the egg was absorbing a lot of mana. He asked Ronan if this place feels strange to him. Ronan asked him what he meant by that. Asel reminded Ronan that Varen said that because of the mana vein, a lot of fantastical and mystical animals should be there. Even regular animals would love to build their nest there. Asel asked Ronan if he could hear any animal sound. Ronan realized that he messed up. He stood up and told Asel that he should get ready for battle because he can smell blood. Asel asked Ronan what he means by he can smell blood. Ronan told him that this means people came here before them and have noticed their presence. Immediately Ronan said this, a group of men who were wearing animal-shaped masks on the other side of the forest shot their arrows at Ronan and Asel. Ronan easily destroyed their arrows. When he saw the arrowhead, he was surprised. He realized that he had seen it before in his past life. At the punitive force camp, Ronan and his fellow soldiers gathered around a campfire. One of the soldiers was explaining how special the arrow he is holding is. He said that the arrow can destroy the head of powerful creatures like orcs. The soldier asked Ronan who was their captain if he wants an arrow. Ronan told him to stop bragging about the arrow because he was caught using it to poach animals. The soldier told Ronan that the arrow is special. He told him that the people that use this arrow are the hunting dogs of the one who has succeeded in over 100 poaching in the Caliboro organization. Ronan was annoyed to find out that the people who shot at them are hunting dogs who work for Caliboro. After stopping the attacks, Ronan told Asel to hide somewhere. He said that he has some things he has to take care of. After saying this, he ran towards the direction of the people who shot at them. The hunting dogs of Caliboro could not believe what they saw. Ronan destroyed all their mana-infused arrows with a single sword. When they saw Ronan running towards them, one of the hunting dogs told the rest to scatter and surround Ronan. Ronan was surprised that the hunting dog could make a quick decision. He knew that this one was different from the ones he met in the forest. He knew that he had to make a plan to catch them all. As the hunting dogs were about to scatter, Ronan stops them by telling them that he is an ally. He told them that he is the youngest hunting dog from the Damas branch. He told them that his name is Ahiyuti. The hunting dogs stopped running and gathered around Ronan. They asked him if he is really a hunting dog. Ronan said that he is. One of the hunting dog who was not wearing a mask told Ronan that he does not believe him. He said that it does not make sense for someone as young as Ronan to join them. Ronan told him to ask the branch wolf if he does not believe him. He told the hunting dog that just because he is not talented does not mean others are not talented too. The hunting dog was angry to hear this. He grabbed Ronan's shirt and told him that he will chop him into pieces. Ronan told him that guys like him always have bad endings. While he was yelling at Ronan, one of his teammates told him to leave Ronan alone because Ronan seemed to know about their organization's rankings and branches, so it will be better for their boss to return and confirm if Ronan is truly a hunting dog. Immediately the hunting dog said this, their boss came out of the woods, His name is Biam and he is the wolf of Demire Branch. When the hunting dog saw his boss, he left Ronan alone and went to explain the situation to him. Ronan was happy to see Biam because if the boss is around, it means that all the hunting dogs in the area are gathered there. Biam told Ronan that he does not know what he is doing here because this part of the forest belongs to their branch. Ronan told them that he does not care because his name is not Ahiyuti. When Biam heard this, he was surprised. Immediately Ronan said this, he used his sword to kill all the hunting dogs that surrounded him in one attack. He rushed to attack Biam. He told him that the name he used felt like it would be perfect for a poacher. After saying this, Ronan cut Biam's head off. Ronan reminded the hunting dog that did not have a mask that guys like him always have bad endings. Immediately he said this, the man's fingers fell off, the man screamed in pain. Ronan told him to stop overreacting. He gave him the map that Varen gave them. He told him that if he does not want to feel more pain, he should write the location of the other branches of Caliboro at the back of the map. The man panicked when he heard this. Ronan thought that the man did not want to do it, so he decided to kill him. The man told him that he will do it. He asked Ronan for a pen to write. Ronan told him to use his bloody fingers to write. After finishing the map, Ronan took a look at it and thanked the man. The man told Ronan that he will be leaving since Ronan promised to set him free once he is done. Immediately Ronan kept the map in his pocket. He told the man that he is not setting him free. He used his sword to split him into two. Asel began to puke when he saw the corpse of the dead animals. Ronan told him to stop overreacting. Asel apologized for the vomit. He told Ronan that the amount of animals Caliboro killed was too much. Ronan told him that it is a crime to let people who work for Caliboro live. When Ronan looked at the corpses, he knew that Professor Varen would be sad to see this. He decided to head back to the capital. As he was about to leave, he noticed that the egg in his pouch was shaking. Ronan asked Asel to look at what happened, but Asel was preoccupied with something. Asel told Ronan to look up. When Ronan looked up, he saw the blood of the dead animals floating in the air. The blood came together and moved close to Ronan and Asel. Ronan decided to draw his sword and attack the blood. As he was about to do this, he noticed his egg floating in the air. The egg moved close to the sea of blood and began to absorb it. Asel asked Ronan what was happening. Ronan said that he does not know, but he is sure that whatever that is inside the egg is not ordinary. After absorbing all the blood, the egg began to hatch. Ronan was extremely happy to see this. He wanted to see what kind of valuable creature that is inside the egg. Immediately the entity hatched. It attacked Ronan's nose. Ronan was shocked that it attacked him. When he looked at the dream bird, he was sure that it is not a bird. Asel said that it looks like a dragon. Ronan also believed that it looks like a dragon. He wondered where Marpez absorbed mana from for it to lay such a unique egg. Ronan told the dragon that it should not have attacked him in the face because this is its first time meeting him. When the dragon heard this, it used magic to fix Ronan's nose. Asel was surprised that a baby dragon could use healing magic and it liked Ronan a lot. Ronan was happy that he got a creature that has different abilities. Asel told Ronan that they need to name the dragon. While they were thinking of names, the dragon sensed something in the surroundings. It rushed towards it. Asel wondered where the dragon was going to. Ronan was impressed that the dragon was able to sense someone was close to them. On the other side of the forest, Balrouz, the errand boy Demire Branch, was running away. Balrouz went to run an errand, but when he came back, all the hunting dogs and his boss were dead. When he went to check what killed them, he saw Ronan and Asel standing next to a sea of blood. Immediately he saw this, he began to run. Unfortunately for him, the dragon began to chase after him. Balrouz tripped on a stick and fell. When the dragon caught up to him, it began to drain his blood. Balrouz began to scream when he saw this. Fortunately for him, Ronan told the dragon, who he named Sita, to stop hurting Balrouz. Asel was surprised that Ronan named the dragon Sita. Ronan said that he already had the name in his mind before. Luckily for Ronan, the dragon liked the name. Balrouz remembered seeing Ronan next to the Sea of Blood. He wondered if Ronan is Sita's owner. Ronan asked Balrouz if he is okay. Balrouz thanked Ronan for saving him. He asked Ronan how he knows his name. Ronan put his sword to Balrao's neck and told him that he does not need to know. He asked Balrao's how he has been and how well he has been poaching as a bloodhound. Balrao's was surprised to hear this. He could not believe that someone called him a bloodhound because he is a common errand boy. Ronan knew that Balrao's will become a bloodhound in the organization because Balrao's was one of the soldiers that served under him. Ronan told Balrao's that he has something he wants him to do for him. After Ronan was done with Balrao's, he filled a tube with the water from Fernando Spring. Acel was surprised to see this. He wondered why Ronan would do such a thing. After he and Ronan arrived at the capital, Ronan sold the water to Maria's father for a high price. Ronan knew that the water would sell incredibly well because it was gotten from a mana vein. Ronan believed that they would not have been able to get such a large amount of money without the help of Professor Varen. He and Acel decided to visit Varen. When they arrived at his door, they saw a sign that said that Professor Varen is out on a business trip. Ronan was sad to see this. He wanted Professor Varen to see Sita because he knew that Professor Varen was curious about what would hatch out of the egg. Ronan was grateful to Professor Varen because thanks to him, he was able to get a map that has the locations of Caliboro's branches and he was able to meet his fellow soldier. When Ronan met Balrao's, he instilled a lot of fear in him so that Balrao's would not dream of betraying him. Acel asked Ronan what he wanted to use his money for because Ronan is exempted from paying school fees since he is the second position in the martial arts department. When Ronan thought about what he wanted to use the money for, he realized that their entrance ceremony will be happening soon. A few days later, Irol arrived at the capital's carriage station. She could not believe how beautiful the capital was. When she arrived, she saw Ronan waiting there for her. Ronan asked her if anything happened after he left. Irol was surprised to hear this. She told Ronan that she is the one who is worried about him. When she woke up in the morning, she saw a fancy carriage outside her house and the coachman told her that he is supposed to give her a ride to the city on the orders of Ronan. Irol asked Ronan how he was able to pay for something like that because he does not have any money. She grabbed Ronan's face and asked him if he is not eating well. Ronan told her not to worry about him. He told her that he is eating well. When Irol heard this, she became calm. She asked Ronan what was on his shoulder. Ronan introduced her to Sita. He told her that Sita will be staying with him for some reasons. After saying this, Ronan grabbed Irol's hand. He told her that he does not have enough time left before he enters the academy. He told her that he has something he really wants to do. Ronan took Irol to a clothing store. When Irol tried on the dresses, she told Ronan that it was too expensive. Ronan told the attendants at the store to pack all the clothes that his sister tried on. Irol was shocked to hear this because she wore a lot of clothes. Ronan told her that it is time for her to receive from him. Irol was very happy to hear this. She began to scream with joy that her little brother was very kind. Ronan did his best to stop her from going outside. After the attendants packed Irol's clothes, Ronan told her that they have to head to the blacksmith workshop to get a brand new sword for him. He told her that his sword was ruined by a crazy person. As he was about to leave the clothing store, he saw Shulafen waiting for him outside. Ronan and Sita were very shocked to see him. Ronan asked him how he knew he was here. Shulafen said that he came to the area to get a new sword because Ronan ruined his former one. He said that he accidentally saw Ronan entering the store so he decided to wait for him. Ronan told Shulafen that he is a stalker. He told him that his sword was more damaged than his own. He told Shulafen that he will show him whose sword is more defective. When Shulafen heard this, he wanted to fight Ronan. Their fight is stopped by Irol. She told Ronan to stop being rude to Shulafen. Ronan tried to explain himself but Irol told him not to talk back. When Shulafen saw this, he was shocked. He could not believe that Ronan has an older sister. Irol apologized for Ronan's behavior. When Shulafen saw Irol apologize, he was completely blown away by her beauty. He thought that he was looking at a goddess. Shulafen began to shake because he did not know how to respond. After regaining his composure, he told Irol that he is completely responsible for the misunderstanding. Irol was happy to meet a nice noble man. She could not believe that Ronan had such a kind friend. She asked him to take care of Ronan for her. Shulafen said he will do it. Ronan was completely blown away by Shulafen's behavior. Shulafen told her that he wants to compensate Ronan for his sword. He said that he does not have any gold on him, so he gave Iral his family's proof of identification. He told her that it will be accepted anywhere in the empire. When Ronan saw this, he was extremely shocked. Shulafen told Iral that if she wants to buy a sword, she should go to the blacksmith on the western end of the street. He told her that the blacksmith shop is a special place that commoners cannot visit, but if they have his family's proof of verification, they can enter easily. He told them that they will get an amazing sword there. After saying this, he left. Ronan could not believe what Shulafen did. The Grangxia proof of verification is a tablet that can buy villages, and yet, Shulafen gave it to his sister. He did not remember Shulafen having such a behavior in the past. At the academy's entrance ceremony, Krava greeted the students. He told the students that all of them have amazing skills and boundless talents. He told them that with their talents and the teachings of the professors, they will be recorded and remembered by the empire. After saying this, he congratulated them on entering the academy. Ronan was not interested in Krava's speech, but he was happy that Krava gave a speech because it made his sister proud of him. After Krava was done with his speech, he snapped his finger and everyone felt magic move around them. When Asel saw this, he told Ronan to look up. When Ronan looked up, he saw the sky shattering into pieces. While he was looking up, he and his other classmates got teleported to an arena. Ronan could not believe that Krava could teleport such a large amount of people by just snapping his fingers. Krava told the freshmen that they are about to have a meeting with their seniors. The meeting between the freshmen and the seniors is called senior-junior meeting. It occurs between freshmen and year 2 seniors. It is a process that is known to be intense. It is a process whereby the first and second ranks represent the freshmen and they are told to fight one among the 4 senior who have their own individual fighting styles. Krava told the audience that this event is made so that the students can compete with each other and learn each other's weaknesses. He believed that this is the best way for students to learn. Krava told the students that the freshmen will be given the chance to choose their opponents and they can choose not to duel if they want to. Ronan was angry to hear this. He believed that this event was created so that the freshmen are put in their place. The people that Ronan and Shulafen had to fight were Nasto, who is rank 1 of the martial arts department, Braum, who is rank 2 of the martial arts department, Irina, who is rank 3 of the martial arts department, and Karun, who is rank 4 of the martial arts department. Braum said that he is happy to face the Empire's Rising Star and the man who defeated the Empire's Rising Star. Ronan was happy about the opportunity to face this martial artist because he wanted to show Iral that he is strong enough to fight anyone. He also wanted to show her how close he is with Shulafen. While thinking of what to do, Krava asked them to begin the duel. When Ronan heard this, he had an idea. He asked Krava if he could make a suggestion. Krava asked him to go ahead. Ronan told Krava that since they are free to choose who they want to fight, he would like to fight all 4 of the seniors. Krava was shocked to hear this. The seniors were extremely angry to hear this, but what made them more angry was that Ronan asked them to fight him together. Krava asked Nabiroz how she wants to take care of this issue. Nabiroz told Krava that he should allow Ronan to do what he wants. She said that in their school, if one has skills, he is free to act how he wants. She said that she will interfere if the duel is looking dangerous. After hearing this, Krava decided to let the duel happen. The 4 sophomore were angry about Ronan's arrogance. Irina thought that Ronan was being arrogant because he was ranked 2nd position in the martial arts department. Nasto told the other sophomores to calm down because while Ronan is arrogant, he is someone who defeated Shulafen in the practical exam. He told them to attack Ronan with all their strength. When Iral saw how tense the air around the arena was, she screamed at Ronan. She told him to forfeit the match if he believes he will get injured. When Ronan heard this, he smiled at her to reassure her. After everyone got ready, Krava told the students to begin the match. Immediately the match began. Nasto attacked Ronan at full speed. Ronan was able to dodge the attack. When Ronan dodged Nasto's attack, he could tell that he and the other 3 sophomores were much stronger than Maria. After Ronan dodged Nasto's attack, Irina began to attack him with two short swords. Ronan was able to block the attacks. While Irina was attacking Ronan, Kurun used his spear to attack Ronan from Irina's back. Ronan was surprised by how good their teamwork is. Kurun used his spear to push Ronan away. As Ronan was about to get up, he saw Braum at his back with his giant sword in the air. Braum said that he wanted to fight Ronan alone, but Ronan disappointed him. Immediately he said this, he attacked Ronan. Ronan knew that Braum's attack is supposed to be a strong finishing attack and the other three were going to attack him immediately. He let his guard down. Ronan was very surprised at how coordinated and smart the sophomores were. Before Braum could land his attack on Ronan, Ronan disappeared. Braum and the other three were surprised to see this. Irina was the only one that was able to notice how fast Ronan was. She could not believe what she was seeing. Before she could do anything, Ronan attacked all four of them at a crazy speed. To his surprise, Braum was able to withstand his attack. He could not believe that Braum still wanted to fight after he destroyed the other sophomores. As Braum was about to attack him, he took a stance. When Braum saw this stance, he could not believe that Ronan was able to copy Nabiro's swordsmanship. Ronan attacked Braum with three slashes just like Nabiro's showed him at the test. Immediately he did this, he broke Braum's sword and knocked him out. After defeating the sophomores, he thanked them for helping him learn a lot. Irel and everyone in the arena were shocked by what just happened. They began to scream in excitement. The four sophomores were surprised that they lost. Nasto said that he has no complaints about how he lost. He wondered where a monstrous guy like Ronan learnt from. When the duel ended, Irel grabbed the man sitting next to her and told him that Ronan is her brother. Ronan was happy to see this because this means Irel won't be worried about him while he stays in the academy. Ronan told his seniors that they performed well. Nasto and the other seniors were surprised to hear this. Ronan told them that he was excited to enter Phil Leon Academy, so he used all his strength to fight. He told them that they are stronger than he expected. He thanked them for accepting his challenge. Acel and Maria were surprised to see this. They thought that Ronan had finally lost his mind. Ronan begged the sophomores to forget the discourtesy he showed them. He told them that he wants to learn a lot of things from them in the future. The seniors did not know how to respond to Ronan's request. While they were thinking of what to do, Braum stood up and told Ronan that he is an excellent junior. He believed that Ronan was rude at first, but now he thinks of Ronan as a well-mannered swordsman. He told Ronan to be proud of his win because he was skilled enough to get it. He took Ronan's hand and raised it in the air to appreciate Ronan. Ronan displayed his social skills so that Irel would not be concerned about him. While Ronan was on stage, a mysterious girl took an interest in him. At night, the students gathered at the dining hall to eat. The students were told that they would be getting an entrance ceremony banquet. Ronan expected it to be a small dinner among students, but to his surprise it was a massive banquet. Maria told him that they are at the most prestigious school in the empire, so a dinner of this level is expected. While Maria was stuffing her face with food, Acel asked Ronan if he has sent his sister back home. Ronan said that he has. He said that Irel did not want to leave him behind because she was still worried. He had to spend some time to calm her down before he sent her off. He asked Sita to follow and protect her. He knew that no monster or person is a threat to Sita. Acel was surprised that Ronan went through such measures to protect his sister. After talking to Acel, Ronan decided to eat. As he was about to taste his meat, Shulafen appeared at his back and asked him if he should be eating comfortably. Ronan was very annoyed to see Shulafen. He asked him if he wants to fight with him again. Shulafen told Ronan that he wants to confirm some important things. Ronan told him to ask his questions. Shulafen asked Ronan if Irel's house is far from the capital. Ronan was surprised to hear this. Shulafen asked Ronan if bandits frequently appear on the road to Irel's house. He asked Ronan if he gave Irel enough security. Ronan did not know how to respond to Shulafen's questions. Shulafen told Ronan that he must have given his sister proper security before she left. Ronan was angry to hear this. He told Shulafen that unless a wyvern attacks his sister will be fine. Shulafen was surprised to hear this. He could not believe that Ronan could not give his sister enough security to protect her from a wyvern. When Ronan heard this, he thought that Shulafen was crazy. He asked Shulafen why he is making such an issue over something that concerns his sister. He asked Shulafen if he believes he means something to Iril. Shulafen began to shake when he heard this. He told Ronan that he is a knight and that is why he wants a woman to get back home safely. While Ronan and Shulafen were arguing, a young girl and a group of boys walked up to them. This girl is the mysterious girl who looked at Ronan when he was on the stage. The girl was shocked to see Shulafen, who she referred to as the Wolf of Granxia, talking a lot. Shulafen was angry to see the girl. He asked her what she wanted. The girl's name is Erzabet Akalugia and she is the first place in the magic department. Erzabet told Shulafen that she is not there to see him. She said that she came to talk to Ronan. Ronan was surprised to hear this. Shulafen told her to go ahead because he is done talking to Ronan. As Shulafen was about to leave, he told Ronan that he wants to send some of his family's guards to protect his sister. Ronan was angry to hear this. He told Shulafen to get lost. Asel grabbed Ronan and asked him if he remembers what Erzabet did in the senior-junior meeting. Ronan said he remembered how dominating she was. He believed that Erzabet used too much magic on her opponent. Erzabet said that she just wanted to put the senior in his place. She told Ronan that the talent he displayed in the duel is quite impressive. She told Ronan that she wants to make him an offer that he could not have dreamed of. She put her hand into her pocket and brought out a necklace with a purple pendant. Ronan was surprised to see this necklace because it is the Akalugia's invitation. The Akalugias are different from other nobles who prioritize bloodlines. They prioritize talent above anything else. They have many talented individuals who work for them. This allowed them to be one of the two pillars that support the empire. They offer an opportunity to anyone who displays potential to become a part of their family. The symbol of this invitation is this necklace. Erzabet was surprised that Ronan did not ask her about what she gave him. She asked Ronan if he knew what it meant. Ronan said that someone mentioned it to him before in the past. In Ronan's past life, Grand Commander Adeshan Akalugia told Ronan that she joined the Akalugia family thanks to her necklace. She told Ronan that a test will be given to anyone who wants to join the family by the patriarch. If the person is talented, they will be able to pass the test easily. She told Ronan that once he makes up for his sins through his accomplishments in this war, he will receive an invitation from the Akalugias. She revealed to him that she believes he is quite talented. Erzabet told Ronan that she hopes he makes a wise decision. She told him that although he is born a beast, if he continues to mingle among the sheep, he will also become a sheep. After saying this, she left. Asel was relieved that she left them. Ronan was surprised that all geniuses have an annoying attitude. He was happy to receive the necklace because he believed that the Akalugias would be helpful to him. Phil Leon Academy is an educational institution that prioritizes a student ability above everything else. Depending on one's grade, their environment can greatly change. An example of this is the student's dormitory system. Nishia Hall is where the intermediate rank students are assigned to. Each person in this hall gets their own room. They also have a high-grade cafeteria. It is a very nice dormitory that provides everything a student needs. Students who make up the bottom 30% are assigned to Kratir Hall. When the new students saw how shabby Kratir Hall looked like, they began to scream. They told the attendant that they are nobles and they cannot stay in such a place. They asked for a better hall and some servants. The attendants told them that there is no employee that works in this hall. He told them that they are four people in a room and the bathrooms are to be shared among them. The new students were shocked to hear this. The attendant said that it is not his fault that they were assigned this hall. He told them that they have to study hard unless they want to stay in this dormitory in the next semester. The students could not believe their faiths. The final hall is the hall assigned to the top 10% of students. It is called the Nibardozer Hall. When Ronan stepped into his room, he was completely blown away. He could not believe that they prepared such a room for students. While Ronan was looking around, he saw a paper in the table. The paper contained the amount of classes the academy offers. Ronan was told to select the classes he would like to attend and submit it. Ronan knew that he still had to get adjusted to the academy, so it would be better for him to choose very little subjects, but he did not want to. He wanted to attend all the classes because they all seemed interesting. After sitting down to think about it, Ronan registered for almost all the classes. He believed that since he is in Phil Leon Academy, he should do his best to learn everything. When Ronan attended his first class, which was the Empire Swordsmanship Basics, the instructor Mr. Abar told Ronan that he no longer needs to take his class. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He told Mr. Abar that he just started the class. Mr. Abar told Ronan that he is also very surprised. He could not believe that Ronan already perfected all the basics of the Empire Swordsmanship techniques. Mr. Abar told Ronan that the rules of the academy states that a professor should allow a student leave once the student has completed everything on the syllabus. He told Ronan that he cannot allow him to stay because he would demotivate the other students. He told Ronan to continue to work hard and not become full of himself. Later in the day, Ronan sat near a river and began to moan. He could not believe that he was chased away from other classes like archery and monster hunting. He never imagined his school life to be like this. While he was thinking of what to do, he hears someone ask him why he is not in class. When he turned around to see who it was instructor Nabiros. Nabiros immediately understood that Ronan already completed all his classes. Ronan asked her if all his classes are going to be like this. He told her that he expected more from Phil Leon Academy. Nabiros was very surprised that he actually completed most of his classes, but she believed it made sense because it only took Ronan one look for him to copy her technique. Nabiros said that as an instructor, she has to make sure that Ronan learned something. She asked Ronan to give her his sword. Ronan did not understand what she wanted to use his sword for. Nabiros took his sword off his hand. Ronan was angry about this. He asked her what she wanted to use it for while he was talking. Ronan felt an explosion in the river. Ronan was surprised to see the explosion. Nabiros was disappointed that Ronan's sword was only able to cause an explosion. She put his sword down. She told Ronan that his sword cannot be called a weapon because it wears the owner down. She told Ronan to look at the technique she is about to use carefully. She brought out her sword in a smooth manner and she used it to split the river into two. Ronan could not believe what he was seeing. When she was done, she put her sword away and asked Ronan if he knows what he is lacking now.
A weapon is a piece of metal that is sturdy and sharp. It is used to fight against one's opponents. It should not break when wielded, and even if it breaks, one can easily obtain a new one. Ronan believed that weapons are expendable until he saw how Nabiros used her weapon. He could not believe what he witnessed. He was certain that he could copy the same slash Nabiros used, but he knew that hers was on a different level. Nabiros told Ronan that he has to be smart about how he uses his weapon because on a battlefield, wasting one's strength can lead to death. She told Ronan that if he is using mana, he has to find a weapon that suits him. She revealed to Ronan that she knows that he cannot use mana. Ronan was surprised to hear this. Nabiros told him that it is amazing that he is able to fight with so much energy despite not having mana. She told Ronan that he will be able to use mana one day, so he has to get a proper weapon to control his power. She told him to attend her class. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He asked Nabiros if he is actually allowed to attend. Nabiros revealed to him that only the second-year students and above are allowed to attend her class, but she is willing to make an exception for Ronan under one condition. She asked him to get a proper weapon. In the next scene, we see Ronan, Asel, and Maria together. Ronan told Asel and Maria what happened with instructor Nabiros. After listening Ronan, Asel understood why Ronan brought them to the forge which Shelafan mentioned. Maria and Asel were surprised when they saw the forge. Maria told Ronan that the forge is too shabby and it looks like it will collapse anytime. She asked Ronan if the Grancia family truly used this awful-looking forge. Ronan told her that they have to step into the forge to know. When they stepped in, they saw a dusty ceiling filled with cobwebs. Ronan could not believe that the inside was more uglier than the outside. He knew that Shelafin would never lie to him about the forge, so he did not understand why it looked awful. While they were looking around, a creature came out of the back room of the forge. The hairy creature asked them who they are. Asel and Maria were terrified to see this creature. Ronan was simply amazed. Ronan was amazed because he never expected that he would see a wolf beastman in a forge. The beastman looked at them with a terrifying gaze and asked them if they're deaf and cannot answer his question. He told them to leave the forge. Ronan showed the beastman the insignia of the Grancia family and told him that he came to buy a weapon. He told the beastman that Shulafin recommended this forge to him because they sell premium weapons. The beastman looked at Ronan and his friends. He noticed the mana that was around Asel and Maria. He told Ronan that the insignia does not mean anything to him. He asked Ronan if he is from Grancia family. He told Ronan that he does not know who leaked the location of their forge, but it does not matter because they don't accept customers like Ronan. Ronan was annoyed to hear this. The beastman licked his teeth and looked at Ronan in a disturbing way. He told Ronan that there is a way for him to get what he wants. He told Ronan to give him Asel's arm in order for him to help him. He revealed to Ronan that he has not eaten for a while, so Ronan would be doing him a favor. Asel was terrified to hear this. He told the beastman that he tastes disgusting. As the beastman walked towards Asel, Ronan looked at the beastman in a menacing way and told him that he has made a big mistake. He used his sword to attack the beastman in the stomach. The beastman got pushed back. Ronan knew that he felt something strange when he attacked the beastman. He asked the beastman how he was able to get an armor. The beastman could not respond immediately because it was still feeling the pain from Ronan's attack. Ronan told the beastman that he does not need to answer him because he will destroy the armor. The beastman got scared when he heard this. He told Ronan that he was just performing a test. Ronan did not understand what the beastman meant. The beastman told him that it is their protocol to verify the skills of people who they have never seen before. He told Ronan that he also wanted to test his invisible armor, so he had to provoke him on purpose. Ronan asked him if he truly expects him to believe such a stupid excuse. The beastman told Ronan that their forge makes weapons for the Grancia family. It would be weird if they did not have a test to verify people's skills. He told Ronan to confirm from Shulafin if he is telling the truth. The beastman apologized to Ronan for going overboard with his provocation. He also apologized to Asel for his prank. He told Asel that he does not eat humans. Asel was relieved to hear this. The beastman introduced himself as Didikin. He told them that he is an apprentice of the forge and sometimes he is the gatekeeper. He told Ronan that the place they are in is the entrance to their forge. The real forge is at the back room. After they entered the back room, Didikin told them to prepare themselves. He pressed a button on the wall and the ground began to go down. Ronan and his friends were surprised to see this. They had never witnessed something similar to an elevator. Didikin told Ronan that this is an elevator made from a magic stone and a pulley. He told Ronan that this is the fastest way to get to the real forge. After moving for a while, the elevator began to slow down. Didikin welcomed Ronan to the largest forge in the empire. This place is called Grand Cappadoce. Ronan could not believe that there was a mini city under the capital. Didikin told Ronan that he should be excited that he passed his test because he is going to introduce him to the best blacksmith in the empire. The scene shifts and we see a man hitting his hammer on a sword. As Ronan and his friends were walking through Cappadoce, they saw many blacksmiths crafting different swords. Ronan could not believe that such a place actually existed. Didikin revealed to Ronan that the forge only provides weapons to the royal family and the nobles. He tells Ronan that every single blacksmith in this place is skilled. However, the best among them is the elder dwarf. The elder dwarf is a master who has melted metal for 400 years. Didikin told Ronan that the elder is stubborn, but his skills are unrivaled, so he respects him. Immediately he said this, he kicked the elder's door with no sign of respect. He told the elder that he brought some guest for him. When the elder heard the voice of the person who was speaking, he immediately knew that it was Didikin. He reminded Didikin that he likes everywhere to be quiet when he is working. Didikin told the elder that he had to kick the door because there were some weapons in front of it. He told the elder whose name is Doron to clean his shop. Doron told Didikin that he nags a lot for a young person. Doron asked Didikin if his guests are strong because he brought them to him. Didikin told Doron that he has tested Ronan's skills and he is sure that Ronan is amazing. Doron was surprised to hear Didikin's remark of Ronan because Ronan looked like a child to him. He told Ronan to show him his swordsmanship because he could learn a lot just by looking at it. Ronan brought out his sword and was prepared to show Doron his swordsmanship. When Doron saw Ronan's sword, he called it trash and he broke it with his hammer. He asked Ronan if he has been using his sword as a weapon for a long time. Ronan was in shock to see Doron break the sword he worked hard to get. He got angry and asked Doron what he was doing. Doron pointed at the swords on the floor and told Ronan to use any of those swords. He told Ronan that he would not have been able to analyze how skilled he is with his trashy sword. He told Ronan that he will give him any sword he picks for free. He assured Ronan that any of the sword he picks will be 100 times better than his trashy sword. Ronan was surprised to hear this. Didikin nods his head at Ronan to tell him that Doron is telling the truth. When Ronan picked up a sword, he could tell that the feeling of this sword was different, but he was not sure if it would change the outcome of his swordsmanship. Before Ronan displayed his swordsmanship, he warned Doron that he will not be at fault if he ends up destroying something. Doron told Ronan that he does not care if he destroys anything. He told Ronan that he just needs to focus on properly displaying his swordsmanship. Upon hearing this, Ronan decided to recreate the slash he saw Nabiros create. He took his position and was ready to perform the slash. Doron recognized Ronan's movement. Upon taking his position, Ronan recreated the slash. The scene shifts and we see an explosion. The other blacksmiths were scared to hear the horrifying sound. They noticed that the sound came from Doron's shop. They wondered if he had destroyed a blast furnace. We are taken back to Ronan and his friends. It turns out the explosion came from the slash that Ronan displayed. Ronan and Doron were shocked to see how damaged the shop was. Ronan did not understand what he did. He told Doron that he never intended to destroy this much. Doron asked Ronan if he is Nabiro's apprentice. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He asked Doron if he knows Nabiro's. Doron revealed to Ronan that he was the one who made Nabiro's sword. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He remembered how smooth Nabiro's longsword was. Doron told Ronan that Nabiro's longsword is called the secret sword, Yurusa. He told Ronan that Yurusa is one of the few masterpieces he made in his life. Ronan told Doron that he never expected his sword to be so much stronger. Doron revealed to Ronan that he thought he was a brat who could not judge his own skills. He hit Ronan and told him that it has been a while since he has met someone as talented as him. Doron told Ronan that being too talented is a problem because it will be hard to forge a sword that suits him. He told Ronan that the sword he just used is already cracking just from a single swing. Ronan asked Doron how he can solve this problem. Doron told him that he will use the highest grade steel and melt it with a special material. He told Ronan that if he can get some byproduct of a wyvern, he might be able to make his sword. When Ronan heard about a byproduct, he brought out Sita's egg shell and asked Doron if the shell would be good enough. When Doron used his hammer that is made of mithril to hit the egg shell, he was very shocked because his hammer was not able to make a dent on the shell. He rushed to ask Ronan if he could really use the egg shell. Ronan told Doron that the egg shell is useless to him. He asked Doron if the shell is enough to make him a sword. Doron with an excited look told Ronan that he should come back for his sword in 2 weeks' time. He promised to make Ronan the best sword in the empire. He told Asel and Maria to go and meet the other masters if they want to get some weapons. Maria was surprised to hear this. Doron told her that he cannot send back the friends of a valuable person empty-handed. He told them to mention his name when they meet the other masters in order for them to be well taken care of. He told them that he would love to make weapons for them, but he cannot do anything until he is done smelting the eggshell. After he said this, he began to hit the egg with all his strength. He was very happy to hear the sound the shell was producing. When Ronan saw this, he immediately knew that this old man is crazy. Underneath Cappadoki, a man wearing a white garment is angry to hear the sound of the blacksmiths hitting iron. He says that he wants to set all the blacksmiths on fire. A woman who is also wearing a white garment tells him to control himself because it is not yet time for them to reveal themselves. While staring at different stone statues, the woman says that it will not be long before they can do as they wish. She said that they will start with the ignorant blacksmiths and from there they will bring the empire to its knees. While looking at a giant statue that is in a crystal, the woman said that the day everything disappears and is buried in light is coming. A few days later, Ronan reflects on how the best blacksmith in the empire is going to make his sword and how his friends are receiving their weapons from other blacksmiths. Ronan knows that the price of their weapons will be quite high, but he did not care because it did not have to pay for it. He used the Grancy of family insignia to pay. The only problem Ronan had was that his sword was going to take some time before it is completed. He wondered how he is going to be spending his time. Asel and Maria both had classes, so he had no one to talk to. While walking around the school, Ronan stops to look at the exclusive training and lecture center of the upper-class students. This center is called the Galilean Building. Ronan remembered that instructor Navy Rose also held her classes here too. Navy Rose told Ronan to attend her class when he has a real weapon. Ronan had been avoiding going to her class, but he believes that he can attend now since he has a temporary weapon. While thinking of what to do, Navy Rose appears beside Ronan with a terrifying look. Ronan was scared to see her. He did not know what to say. Navy Rose grabbed Ronan's ear. She asked him why he has not attended her class when he has gotten a weapon. She asked Ronan if he was skipping her class. Ronan said that he wasn't. He wanted to explain himself, but Navy Rose did not give him the chance to. She held his ear and told him to follow her. Ronan begged her to let his ear go because he was in so much pain. While Ronan was screaming in pain, a girl carrying some files stops when she hears Ronan's voice. The girl looked outside the window and wondered who made such a sound. While the girl was looking outside, someone bumps into her. Instead of apologizing, the boy told her not to block the road. The girl began to apologize to the boy whose name is Cardan. The boy told her that she is slow for a teacher's assistant. Cardan called the girl a loser and told her that she should prepare for today's lessons. The girl picked up her files. She told Cardan that she will do it immediately at the first sparring room. The students gather around because Navy Rose wanted to address them. She introduced Ronan to the students and told them that Ronan will be joining their class. Ronan bowed his head to greet his seniors. Some seniors were surprised that Ronan skipped a grade and joined their class, while other seniors thought that Ronan did not look strong compared to the rumors about him. Ronan was annoyed to hear the seniors' gossips. He was also happy that he saw some seniors who he recognized. He was sad to see Shelafin in the class too. While Ronan was looking at the seniors, the teacher's assistant entered the hall. She apologized to Navy Rose for being late to class. Ronan was surprised to hear her voice. He knew that he had heard this voice before. The girl ran to Navy Rose and asked her if she is really late. Navy Rose told the girl to catch her breath and not worry about it. Navy Rose told the girl to introduce herself to Ronan because he has to know the teaching assistant. The girl walked up to Ronan. She told him that she is a second-year martial arts major who is also the teacher's assistant. She told Ronan that her name is Adeshan with a smile. Adeshan Akalushia was acknowledged for her incredible ability to command. She was the first woman to rise to the Grand Commander position. She dominated the battlefield with her cool-headed judgment and outstanding leadership. She was known as the Iron Lady. Those who served under her used to say that blood does not run in Adeshan's body, instead iron flows through it. After serving under Adeshan, Ronan never expected her to have such a lively expression. He could tell that the Adeshan in front of him did not know anything about the regression. He wondered if he should fulfill Adeshan's last request before she died. While thinking of how to talk to Adeshan, Ronan noticed something odd about her. The other students were disturbing her to teach them. Some were even sending her in errands. Adeshan was like a servant in the hall. Ronan did not understand why she was working like an attendant when she is a teacher's assistant. While he was staring at Adeshan, Cardan walked up to Ronan. He asked Ronan to duel with him. Ronan did not understand why he requested for duel. He believed that it was sudden. Cardan introduced himself to Ronan. He told Ronan that he is a third-year student. He revealed to Ronan that he has heard amazing things about his interview, so he would like to duel Ronan to learn from him. Ronan told Cardan that he has something on his mind right now, so he cannot have a duel with him. Cardan thought that Ronan did not want to duel him because he was not carrying his weapon. He shouted at Adeshan. He called her a loser and told her to bring his spear. Adeshan said that she will go get it. Ronan was annoyed to hear this. He could not believe that this dimwit called Adeshan a loser. He could not believe that this bastard was speaking to Adeshan as he wished. Adeshan handed the spear to Cardan, but he got angry. He called her an idiot and asked her why she brought a long spear when he has changed his weapon to a short spear. Adeshan was surprised to hear this. She apologized to Cardan. She told him that she brought a long spear because that was what he used in the last class. Cardan was annoyed to hear Adeshan's excuse. He began to hit the spear on her head and told her that she should not talk back to him. He told her that she does not have the right to attend their class, but she got in after she begged Navy Rose, and yet she cannot do some little chores. He asked her if she has no conscience or shame. Ronan could not believe what he was seeing. He held Cardan's spear. Cardan was surprised to see this. He asked Ronan what he was doing. Ronan told him that he does not know what he will do, so he accepts. Cardan did not understand what Ronan meant when he said that he accepts. Ronan called him a loser bastard and told him that he accepts the duel with a terrifying look. Cardan was surprised that Ronan was being hostile to him. He asked Ronan if he is accepting the duel because of Adeshan. He asked Ronan if he knows anything about Adeshan. He licked his lips in a disgusting manner and asked Ronan if he is protecting Adeshan because they are both commoners. Ronan gave Cardan his spear and told him to defend himself if he does not want to die. Ronan used a wooden sword to attack Cardan. Cardan was surprised by the weight of the attack. He could not believe that Ronan had so much power even though he was not using mana. Ronan pushed Cardan away with his sword. He told Cardan that because he complained that he did not want to use a long spear, he decided to change it for him. Immediately Ronan said this, Cardan's spear split into two. Ronan asked him if he liked the spear now. Cardan was annoyed to see this. He told Ronan to know his place. He rushed to attack Ronan. He asked Ronan if he believes that he will be fine after humiliating him. The moment he came close to Ronan, Ronan cut his spear into pieces. After cutting his spear, Ronan told Cardan that he will be fine, so he should worry about himself. Immediately he said this, he started beating Cardan mercilessly. He broke Cardan's face and hip. After getting beaten up, Cardan lost consciousness and fainted. Ronan told him that he should be happy that they are in the academy because if they had met outside he would be dead. The other students could not believe that Cardan actually lost to Ronan because he is ranked high among the third-year students. Ronan walked up to the other students and told the mannerless bastard who asked Adeshan to get her a new towel to wash her towel herself if it smells. With a terrifying look on his face, Ronan asked the student if Adeshan is her servant. The student freaked out when she saw the look on Ronan's face. Ronan asked the student to come to him because he is going to beat her up. Adeshan tried to stop Ronan when she heard what he said. She ran in front of Ronan and told him that she does not know why he is doing any of this. She assured Ronan that she is fine. Ronan told her to move aside. He told her that he cannot hold himself back when she is being looked down on, especially by this idiots. Ronan believed that no one in the empire should be allowed to discriminate and abuse Adeshan. He moved Adeshan aside and told her that he will not stop until he beats up every student in this class. Maybe Rose told Ronan to stop what he is doing. Immediately she said this, Ronan felt a mysterious energy that held him down, while releasing a terrifying energy. Navy Rose told Ronan that she will not ask him to take responsibility for the fight he had with Cardan because more unfortunate incidents can happen in real battles. However, if Ronan escalates things any further, she will no longer overlook his actions. She told Ronan to drop his sword and walk away. When Ronan heard this, he realized that he was not able to move. He looked back to see Navy Rose, but what he saw was a giant snake that was ready to devour him. Ronan was surprised to see the aura of the unprecedented sword saint. Navy Rose told Ronan that what he wants to do cannot be considered as a duel. As the person in charge of the class, Navy Rose informed Ronan that she cannot let the class deviate any further. Ronan told Navy Rose that she must have known what her teaching assistant was going through, and yet she did nothing to help. Navy Rose told Ronan that it is a problem that does not involve him. She informed Ronan that this will be his last warning. She asked him to stop. Ronan told her that it does not matter if she is the unprecedented sword saint. He told her to get lost. Navy Rose was sad to hear this. She attacked Ronan with a skill called Grieving Snake. Ronan was terrified to see this attack. The scene shifts and we see Ronan in the past with Grand Commander Adeshan. Ronan remembered asking Adeshan why she volunteered to take up the position of commander when everyone declined. Adeshan told Ronan that one day he will understand that there are some things you cannot force someone else to do because it is your destiny. Ronan always wondered what Adeshan was thinking when she said this. He was curious about the kind of weight she was carrying on her shoulders alone. Ronan remembered Adeshan's last moments. He remembered her telling him that she is sincerely sorry for passing her burden to someone else. She told Ronan to not forgive her for her sin. After seeing this memory, Ronan woke up and screamed. He looked around and noticed that he was on a bed. Someone asked him what was wrong with him. The person asked him if he had a nightmare. Ronan was surprised that the person who asked him this question is Adeshan. Ronan called Adeshan General when he woke up. Adeshan was surprised to hear this. She asked Ronan about what he is talking about. Ronan laughs and tells Adeshan that he made a mistake. He tells her not to worry about it. Adeshan was very confused by Ronan's behavior. Ronan asked her if he is currently in the clinic. Adeshan told him that he is. She told him that Nabiroz asked her to bring him here. She revealed to Ronan that Nabiroz said that she will correct his behavior in the supplementary classes. When Ronan heard this, he immediately knew that he messed up and Nabiroz is going to kill him. After passing on Nabiroz's message, Adeshan asked Ronan if he was angry for her sake when he fought Nabiroz. Ronan was startled when he heard Adeshan's question. He looked away from her and told her that the reason he fought is because he is an upright gentleman who values manners a lot. Adeshan immediately knew that Ronan was lying when he said this. She told him that he is a bad liar. She told Ronan not to hate Cardan and the other students too much. She said that she understands why they treat her like that. Ronan was shocked to hear this, with an angry look on his face. Ronan told Adeshan that she did not do anything wrong other than working hard as a teaching assistant. He asked her why she is even a teaching assistant in the first place. Adeshan was surprised to hear this question. Ronan told Adeshan that he understands the fact that Nabiroz allowed the students to misbehave because they are young and they got caught up in the moment, but he will never accept the fact that an instructor turned a blind eye to the evil deeds of her students. He asked Adeshan if she is not angry with Nabiroz. Adeshan smiled and told Ronan not to misunderstand anything. She told him that the reason Nabiroz turned a blind eye to her situation is because she asked her to. Ronan was shocked to hear this. He thought Adeshan was spouting nonsense. Adeshan told him that she is enjoying privileges that she does not deserve. She revealed to Ronan that one has to reach the level of sword expert to attend Nabiroz class, but even after taking a one-year leave from school, she can barely control any aura. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He could not believe that Grand Commander Adeshan, who had such an incredible aura on the battlefield, also had a time when she was powerless. Adeshan told Ronan that she asked Nabiroz to turn a blind eye to whatever treatment the students gave her. She asked for this favor because she did not want to burden Nabiroz, who accepted her as her teaching assistant. She told Ronan that she is enjoying a lot of privileges, so she has to pay the price for it by enduring any humiliation. She told Ronan that she can handle it, so he should not worry. She thanked Ronan for what he did for her. She told him that she used to believe that she had gotten used to the trivial things, but today was a bit painful for her. Ronan asked Adeshan if the reason she is going through such lengths is because she wants to become a general. Adeshan was surprised to hear this. She did not understand how Ronan was able to find out about her goal. With a smile on her face, she told Ronan that her dream is to become the Grand Commander of the Empire. She told him that while her dream may sound stupid coming from someone who has not reached the level of a sword expert, she does not plan to give up. She told Ronan that she is confident in military science and tactics, and she is working hard to reach her goal. After saying this, she realized that it is already time for her next class. She told Ronan to take a good rest before going back to class. Ronan thanked her for watching over him. Adeshan smiled and told him not to worry about it. After saying this, she left. When Adeshan left the clinic, Ronan remembered her last moments. He remembered Adeshan telling him that if they ever meet in the past, he should advise her to stop trying to become a general and just focus on tailoring, with a smile on her face. She told Ronan that she has done a lot of things, but she has never tried tailoring. Ronan was in a dilemma. He did not know how to tell Adeshan to give up on her dream and try being a tailor. A few days later, Ronan, Asel and Maria all went to the Grand Cappadoki because Doron told them that he wants to see them. When Ronan and his friends arrived at the entrance of the forge, there was nobody there. Ronan was angry to see this because Doron sent him a letter through a carrier pigeon in the middle of the night. Doron wrote that he has created a masterpiece and he wants them to come over to get it. While looking around, Ronan accidentally steps on an helmet. He kicked the helmet away in anger and said that the forge is too dirty. He could not believe that they treat customers so poorly. Maria was surprised by how Ronan reacted. She asked Asel why Ronan is so sensitive these days. Asel said that he has no idea why Ronan is so angry. Ronan told his friends that they have to go to the forge themselves. Asel and Maria were surprised to hear this. Maria asked Ronan if he is allowed to do such a thing. Ronan reminded Maria that Doron was the one who asked them to come see him. He told her to stop talking and follow him. They stepped into the elevator and Ronan pressed the secret button. While the elevator was going down, Ronan said that Doron is an old man with poor customer service. He said that he will deal with Doron once he meets him. Maria and Asel could not believe how insane their friend was. As the elevator moved further down, Ronan saw something that shocked him. The forge was engulfed in flames. Ronan did not understand what was going on. He looked around and found people lying unconscious on the ground. Acel immediately called Ronan's attention to a rock giant. The rock giant was chasing after the blacksmiths. Ronan did not understand why rock giants would be in the forge. Acel asked Ronan for their next course of action. Ronan grabbed Acel by his waist and carried him up. He put his leg on the elevator rails and prepared to jump. Acel was very confused by the situation. Ronan told Maria to go back up and bring any master or soldier she can find. Immediately he said this, he jumped down from the elevator. He asked Acel to use his telekinesis. Acel immediately used a skill called Invisible Hand. The scene shifts and we see the blacksmiths about to get crushed by a rock giant. Fortunately, Ronan jumped over the giant and destroyed its hand. When he landed on the ground, he said that there is a lot on his mind these days and his head is a bit stuffy. With a terrifying look on his face, he told the giant that it chose a wrong day to attack this place. The giant used its other hand to attack Ronan. When its hand got close to Ronan, Ronan dodged the attack and jumped on the giant's hand. He leaped off the giant's shoulder and destroyed its head. The blacksmiths who Ronan saved could not believe that someone as young as Ronan could defeat a rock giant in one blow. Ronan climbed on top of the giant and asked the blacksmiths to explain their current situation. The blacksmiths told Ronan that dozens of rock giants barged into the forge in groups. The blacksmiths said that they do not know why the rock giants attacked them. They came out from somewhere underground and destroyed everything as they saw fit. They killed and captured several blacksmiths, including Doron. After capturing some blacksmiths, they went back to where they came from. The blacksmiths revealed to Ronan that Didikin tried to fight the rock giants, but he failed and got taken. The blacksmiths told Ronan that it will not be long before the captured blacksmiths are eaten. After hearing about the situation, Ronan stood up and asked the blacksmiths if the giant he killed was the last one. The blacksmiths said yes. Ronan ordered Acel to check for other injured people with Maria. He told Acel to heal anyone they find. He asked Acel to take Sita with him to assist him in healing. Acel was shocked to hear this. He asked Ronan what he is going to do. Ronan told Acel that he is going to save the captured blacksmiths, especially since he has something he wants to get from Doron. The scene shifts and we see Doron holding a sword while shaking in fear. He told Didikin that while he is grateful that he came to save him, it will be better for Didikin to run away. Two rock giants were forcing their way through an enclosed space in order to get to Doron and Didikin. Upon seeing the situation at hand, Doron urged Didikin to run away quickly. He told Didikin that he will be able to survive with his invisible armor. Didikin asked Doron to shut up. He told him that things are already tough for him as it is, so he does not need Doron to be spewing some nonsense. With an angry look on his face, Didikin told Doron to swing his sword if he has the strength to say such ridiculous things. Doron told Didikin that he cannot swing this sword because it is his best masterpiece. He said that he does not want to taint the sword with his stupid swordsmanship. Didikin called Doron a crazy old man when he heard this. He told Doron that this is not the moment for him to act crazy about swords. While they were talking, the rock giants broke into the cave they were hiding in. A rock giant tried to crush them with his hand. Doron thought that they were going to die, but to his surprise, Didikin blocked the giant's attack. The moment Didikin blocked the attack, he could tell that all the functions and benefits that his armor provided him got destroyed in one hit. When the giant saw that Didikin blocked the first attack, it decided to attack him again. Before the giant's hand reached Didikin, he began to regret not creating everything he has dreamed about. Before the giant's hand could touch Didikin, Ronan appeared at the back of the giant and cut the giant into pieces. He thanked Didikin for surviving and asked him to leave the remaining giants to him. Doron and Didikin were very surprised to see Ronan standing in their front. Didikin asked Ronan how he was able to get to this place because there is a lot of giants along the way. Ronan smiled and told Didikin that he killed all the rock giants and saved the remaining blacksmiths. Didikin and Doron could not believe what they heard. Didikin wondered if such a thing was possible. Ronan stretched his hand out and asked Doron to give him the new sword because his current sword is already ruined and cannot be used anymore. Doron gave the sword to Ronan. He told Ronan that while the hilt is not yet finished, the sword is still usable. Ronan thanked him for the sword. He took a stance and unsheathed the sword. The moment he did this, more rock giants entered the cave they were in. The giants rushed to attack Ronan. Ronan decided to test the sword by using a light swing. The moment he swung the sword, He destroyed all the rock giants that were close to the cave in one blow. Ronan was completely blown away by the level of power the sword possessed. Didikin was very surprised to see what happened, while Doron was extremely happy with his creation. Ronan wondered about the weapon he was holding. Doron asked Ronan if he likes La Mancha. Ronan was surprised by the name of the weapon. Doron told him that he got the name from his favorite daydreamer. With an excited look on his face, Doron told Ronan that the sword is so light that you can barely feel the weight on your hands, and the material is sturdier than mithril so it can withstand all swordsmanship. La Mancha began to suck the blood of the dead rock giants. Doron revealed to Ronan that he did not cast any enchantments on the sword, and yet it is able to restore the damage it has taken by absorbing blood. Ronan wondered if the reason La Mancha has this ability is because it is made out of Cetus shells. Ronan told Doron that he is more amazing than he expected. Doron told Ronan that he is glad that he likes the sword. Didikin was confused by the situation. He could not believe that Ronan and Doron were complimenting each other in their current situation. He told Ronan that they are the only blacksmiths left, so it is better they get out of this cave. Ronan was relieved to hear this. He told Didikin to take Doron out of there. He said that he has something he needs to check. Didikin asked Ronan about what he wants to check. With a menacing look on his face, Ronan said that there is a rat hiding in this place, and the rat is very big. The scene shifts, and we see the mysterious man and woman standing next to a gigantic rock giant. Didikin did not understand what Ronan meant when he was talking about rats. He asked Ronan to talk more on it. Ronan told him that the situation does not make any sense to him. He revealed to Didikin that he knows a lot about the habits of rock giants. He told Didikin that rock giants are not known for mobbing. They don't attack people first unless they are angered by humans. They are well-behaved creatures. He placed his hand on the rock giant and told Doron and Didikin that he has never seen such a suspicious mark on rock giants. Doron was shocked to see the mark. He called it a magic circle. Ronan asked him if he recognized the magic circle. Doron told Ronan that he is not well versed in magic, but the reverberation of the mana is quite crafty. He told Ronan that the magic circle is the reason why the rock giants went wild. He wondered about who would do such a horrible thing. Ronan said that he does not know. While looking at the footprints of the giants, he said that he will find the person responsible. The scene shifts, and we see Ronan running in the cave. As Ronan was going deeper into the cave, he became certain that he was on the right path to catch the villains. He was certain that he was on the right path because in the footprints of the giants, he could see the footsteps of humans in them. There was also a defense system type mana stone to stop intruders from entering the cave. Ronan was surprised by how prepared the villains were. As he moved deeper into the cave, he started hearing some people talking. He decided to hide by a boulder to get a look at the crazy bastards who angered the rock giants. When Ronan looked at the direction of the humans, he saw something terrifying. He saw a rock giant that was much bigger than the average rock giants, and its body was covered in crystals. A man and a woman who wore a white garment were standing next to the rock giant. Ronan immediately knew that these people were the ones responsible for the destruction of the forge and the killing of the blacksmiths. But he could not comprehend what he was seeing. This rock giant was much bigger than the other rock giants, that it made the rock giants Ronan defeated look like children when compared to it. Due to the fact that the rock giant was not moving, Ronan realized that it has been sealed. He was happy to see this because he did not know what he would do if he had to fight such a terrifying monster. While Ronan was looking at the giant, the woman tells the man that there is an intruder in the cave. The man asked the woman if she is certain. The woman assured the man that she is very certain. She told the man that the brainwashing link that she had cast on the other rock giants have been disconnected. She told the man that the link was disconnected by a third party. The man was annoyed to hear this. He said that the idiotic imperial soldiers acted fast for once in their life. The man asked the woman for their next course of action. He told her that they do not have any rock giants left, and they cannot operate the crystal rock giant. With a terrifying look on his face, he asked the woman if he should just kill the intruder by himself. The woman told the man, whose name is Edwin, to not bother himself. She told Edwin that they have already destroyed most of the surrounding facilities, which will greatly affect the output of the Empire's manufacturers. She warned the man that if their identities are revealed, a certain person will be angry. She told the man that it is better for them to leave the cave and retreat. Edwin told the woman, whose name is Cirilla, that she is too rigid and careful. With fire coming out of his hand, Edwin asked Cirilla if he should get rid of the thing. Cirilla told him to do as he please. Edwin turned around and told Ronan to stop hiding, with a creepy smile on his face. He told Ronan that he can smell the sulfur of blacksmiths from him. Immediately he says this, he attacks Ronan with his fire magic. The magic caught Ronan off guard, but he still managed to dodge it. Edwin asked Ronan for his identity. He commended Ronan for being agile enough to dodge his attack. He told Ronan that he is going to tie up his feet first. Immediately he said this. A lot of fire arrows surrounded Ronan. Ronan was surprised to see this. He could not believe that someone was able to quickly materialize magic on such a large scale easily. He immediately realized that Edwin was not an average magician. Edwin removed his cap and asked Ronan about how he was able to get so deep into the cave. He told Ronan that it is not easy for anyone to get through their defense system. Ronan told them that he also wants to know their identities. With a smile on his face, he told Edwin that even if he and the woman were very eager to see each other, they should not be meeting so deep in a cave. Edwin was surprised to see that Ronan could still make a joke in his current situation. He told Cirilla that it will be fun to kill Ronan. Cirilla told him to stop wasting time and just do what he has to do, with a smile on his face. Edwin told Cirilla that it will be good for them to have some fun. He reminded Cirilla that it will not be long before the Empire is buried in the starlight. Ronan's eyes turned red when he heard this. He was extremely shocked to hear this because this was Ahiyudi's last words to him. He asked Edwin to explain what he just said. With a menacing look on his face, he asked Edwin if he understands the meaning of what he just said. Edwin was surprised to see the sudden change in Ronan's mood. He did not understand what could trigger such a change. Ronan told Edwin and Cirilla that they have to come with him because he has a lot of questions that he wants to ask them. Edwin thought that Ronan had gone crazy out of fear. He could not believe that Ronan wanted to capture them. He activated his fire magic on his hand and asked Ronan if he believes that he can actually capture them. He raised his hand and was ready to attack Ronan. Unfortunately for him, Ronan cut off his hand at a crazy speed. Before Edwin could do anything, Ronan cut off his lower body. With a terrifying look on his face, Ronan told Edwin that it is possible for him to capture them, so they should just shut up and receive their beatings. Edwin screamed in pain as his body fell apart. Cirilla was terrified when she realized that even Edwin could not react to Ronan's attacks. Ronan grabbed Cirilla by the neck and told her to obediently answer his questions unless she wants to end up like Edwin. Cirilla immediately mustered her strength and used a skill called Mana Shield to push Ronan back. Ronan was sad to see this. Due to Cirilla's action, he understood that she was not ready to answer him obediently. Ronan noticed that his hand was shaking from Cirilla's attack. He was surprised by how sturdy the shield was. Of course, this did not matter to Ronan. He used his sword to cut her mana shield into pieces. Cirilla did not understand what was going on. She could not believe that someone could cut her mana shield. Ronan pegged Cirilla down with his leg and stabbed her on her shoulder with his sword. Cirilla screamed in pain when this happened. With a terrifying look on his face, Ronan removed Cirilla's cap to see her face. He was surprised to see that Cirilla is a half-elf. He could not understand why a half-elf would be associated with such a magician. He asked her about what they are doing together. While Ronan was trying to question Cirilla, someone fires a magic skill called Explosion at him. Of course, this does not bother Ronan. He used his sword to cut the attack into half. The attack hit the gigantic rock giant which was behind Ronan. Ronan was certain that he cut Edwin's limbs, but he did not understand how Edwin was able to take a new form. Edwin's entire body was covered in vines. He told Ronan to get away from Cirilla. Ronan told Edwin that he has not fully grasped their situation yet. He used his sword to stab Cirilla in the leg. Edwin became scared when he saw how Ronan acted. With a horrifying look on his face, Ronan told Edwin that he and Cirilla are doomed. He brings out his sword from Cirilla's leg and began to stab her in the same location repeatedly. He told Edwin that either they listen to him obediently or he gives Cirilla a taste of amputation. Edwin was terrified to hear this. Ronan asked Edwin if Cirilla's body parts will grow like his after the amputation. When Edwin heard this, he put away his magic and accepted Ronan's demand. Ronan removed his sword from Cirilla's leg and told Edwin that he also does not wish to spill more blood. He told Edwin that it will be bad for him if they die in this place. When Ronan looked down to see how Cirilla was doing, he saw Cirilla smiling like a crazy person. He did not understand why she was smiling. When he looked up, he saw the hand of the crystal rock giant charging towards him. Ronan was in a daze. He did not know when Cirilla activated the rock giant. He immediately used his sword to block the attack. Unfortunately for him, he was pushed back. He got thrown into a boulder. Edwin walked up to Cirilla to check if she was alive. Cirilla told him that she is all right. She thanked him for saving her. She thanked Edwin for diverting Ronan's attention with his attack earlier. She informed Edwin that she would have not been able to hinder Ronan's perception with magic if Edwin had not diverted his attention, and she would not have been able to activate the rock giant. Cirilla informed Edwin that although she was only able to activate the giant's hand, she is certain that Ronan is heavily injured. Edwin told her to head back to the church to inform them about the current situation. He told her that he is going to end Ronan. Cirilla told him to be careful. She told him Ronan is a monster with the face of a child. Edwin assured her that he won't be reckless. Edwin was certain that Ronan is not a child. He believed that if he did not kill Ronan now, Ronan will become a huge threat to them later in the future. He assured himself that he will not lose to Ronan again. Unfortunately for him, the moment Ronan got up, he cut off his lower body parts. Then he cut Edwin into pieces. With a terrifying look on his face, he told Cirilla that he has already informed her that he has a lot of questions to ask her. Cirilla was terrified to see Ronan. She could not believe that a young boy could be terrifyingly powerful. She activated a magic spell and began to panic. She asked Ronan how he is able to move even though he is heavily injured. Ronan told her that he will never let them go. Immediately he said this, he felt a lot of pain in his body. The injuries he had acquired in this battle were wearing him down. He could not understand why his body was not listening to him. Cirilla did not understand how she got into her current situation. She was angry, but she knew that she could not win against Ronan. She decided to head back to her church to report the situation. She opened a portal and told Ronan to prepare himself. With a horrifying look on her face, she told Ronan that she will find out everything about him, and she will take away everything from him. She promised him that she will kill his family, lover, and friends. Ronan was annoyed with himself when he heard what Cirilla said. He finally managed to get a clue about the future. He did not want it to escape from him. He did not want the future to repeat itself. He reached his hand out and began to scream at Cirilla. He asked her to stop moving. While he was screaming, Navy Rose entered the scene and told Cirilla to stop in a terrifying tone. The moment Cirilla heard Navy Rose's voice, she froze in fear. Navy Rose told her that she has a lot of questions for her. Ronan was surprised to see Navy Rose. Navy Rose told Cirilla that she wants to confirm something. The moment she said this, her aura took the shape of a giant snake that was ready to devour Cirilla. With a horrifying look on her face, Navy Rose asked Cirilla what gave her the courage to touch her disciple. Navy Rose told Ronan that she heard about what happened. Ronan smiled and told her that she has good timing. He told Navy Rose that he never expected to see her in this place. Navy Rose ignores him and told him that he must have a lot of energy for him to be talking. With a serious look on her face, Navy Rose told Ronan that she has to take care of Cirilla first. Immediately she said this, we see the giant snake surround Cirilla. Cirilla was stricken with fear. While shaking in fear, Cirilla realized that there is only one person in the world who has an aura that looks like a giant snake. She realized that the unprecedented sword saint was the one behind her. She could not understand why Navy Rose would be in the forge. She knew that she had to run away, but her body could not move due to fear. Navy Rose grabbed Cirilla's mouth. She told Cirilla that she has done something she should not have even thought about. With a horrifying look on her face, Navy Rose told Cirilla that what angers her the most is the fact that Cirilla hurt her disciple. Cirilla was terrified to hear this. She knew that she messed up. Navy Rose told her that she will experience some horrifying things. Immediately she said this. The giant snake opened its mouth and destroyed Cirilla mentally, before Cirilla fainted. She told the star that she was sorry for not completing her mission. Immediately Cirilla fainted. Navy Rose told Ronan that he worked very hard. She told him that after they treat the people who got wounded, they will report the situation to the principal, while on the floor. Ronan asked Navy Rose if the place Cirilla is going to experience the horrifying things is Rodolin Prison. Navy Rose told Ronan that he is correct. She asked him about why he asked her the question. Ronan became scared when he heard Navy Rose answer his question. He had already heard about Rodolin Prison in his past life. Rodolin Prison is also called the Fortress of Screams. It is a prison floating in the middle of the sea. It is where criminals who rebelled against the Empire are imprisoned. The prison is famous for interrogations and being able to squeeze any kind of confession through any means possible. Ronan stood up and asked Navy Rose to allow him join in on Cirilla's interrogations. Navy Rose was surprised to hear this. She asked Ronan about what he is talking about. She told him that the prison is not a place for him. Ronan grabbed her hand and begged her to do him a favor. He told her that this issue is really important to him. Navy Rose was surprised to see Ronan pleading sincerely. The scene shifts and we see the knights and the priests taking care of the injured people. We see Maria, Asel, and Sita tired after doing their best to take care of the wounded. Asel told Maria that Ronan should have returned by now. He asked Maria if something happened to Ronan. Immediately Asel said this. Ronan came to greet them. Maria and Asel were surprised to see him. Ronan told them that he heard about what they did while he was gone. He told the three of them that they did a great job. He told Maria that he heard that she searched for reinforcement while Asel and Sita saved more than half of the buried blacksmiths. Ronan asked them if they got hurt anywhere. Maria told Ronan that he should not be the one to ask such a question. Asel told Ronan that he is the one who is covered in injuries. With a scared look on Asel's face, he asked Ronan to sit down and get treated. Ronan told Asel not to worry about him. He told Asel that he already got treated on his way up. He told Asel to take a break. Ronan looks at Edwin's and Cirilla's bodies. With a menacing look on his face, he said that he has some business to take care of. A few hours later, Ronan, Navy Rose, and some soldiers stood at the edge of a cliff. This cliff is called the Cliff of Gringno Forest. It is the rendezvous area for Rodolin convoys. After waiting for a while, the convoy unit of Rodolin arrived. The convoy arrived on a flying griffin with a carriage attached to its back. When the griffin landed on the ground, the members of Rodolin immediately came out to greet Navy Rose. The convoy members were all wearing a creepy crow mask to hide their faces. One of the men stepped up and told Navy Rose that they have received the Empire's calling, and they came to escort the criminals. While looking at the bodies of the criminals, Navy Rose told the man that Edwin has the ability to constantly heal himself, so they have to pay attention when they interrogate him. The man said that their interrogator will be happy to interrogate Edwin. The man said that something interesting will finally be coming to their prison. The members of the convoy picked up the bodies of the criminals. The man told Navy Rose that they will contact her once the interrogations are over. He told Navy Rose that she should continue to work hard for the peace of the Empire. Immediately he said this. The convoy left. Navy Rose told Ronan that it will take a week before Rodolin is able to squeeze any information out of the criminals. She told him that she will let him know when they call her. She urged him to stay on standby so that he can move right away when she calls him. Ronan accepted the instructions and thanked her for helping him. The scene shifts and we see the Grand Cappadocia being rebuilt. The forge was quickly reconstructed thanks to the support of the Empire. Ronan returned to the academy and spent his time taking supplementary classes. A few days later, at Rodolin prison, we see a man using a plier to forcefully remove a prisoner's teeth. While the prisoner was screaming in pain, the interrogator said that he was so immersed in what he was doing that he forgot something important. With a horrifying look on the interrogator's face, he said that it is finally time for some guests to arrive. The scene shifts and we see the interrogator without his mask. The old man who happens to be the interrogator stepped out of the cell to greet Navy Rose and Ronan. He introduced himself as the interrogator of the criminals and as the one who will escort them. With a smile on his face, he told them that his name is Karaka. He asked them if they would like to meet the criminal right away. Navy Rose told him that they would. She told him that she would like to hear about the progress of the interrogations on their way to the cell. Karaka accepted this request. He turned around to show them the way in. Ronan was surprised to see Karaka. He told Navy Rose that he never expected a nice-looking old man to be the interrogator of Rodolin. He told her that he does not really believe that the man is an interrogator. Navy Rose smiled when she heard this. She told Ronan that everyone always says the same thing when they first meet Karaka. She told Ronan that he should not judge a book by its cover. She told Ronan that he will soon find out why Karaka is called the worst nightmare. The scene shifts and we see Karaka escorting Ronan and Navy Rose in an hallway. Karaka told Navy Rose that he will tell her the key points because the cell is not far away. He told Navy Rose that the criminals belong to an organization called Nebula Clagier. Navy Rose told Karaka that she has never heard of the organization. She asked him if the organization is similar to Calabaro. Karaka told her that Nebula Clagier is more dangerous because their identities are unknown. Karaka told them that the Nebula Clagier is responsible for things like the great fire that swept the Nalanda Granary and the explosion of Eatman Magic Engineering Institute. Karaka revealed to Ronan and Navy Rose that Nebula Clagier was behind the large-scale incidents of unknown cause that have occurred in the past year. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He could not believe that such a dangerous organization existed in his past life, and he did not know about it. He asked the interrogator if the criminals mentioned anything about a starlight or the arrival of the star. Karaka was surprised to hear this. He told Ronan that it is his first time hearing such words. Ronan told him that he picked up those words from when he was capturing the criminals. He told Karaka that those words seemed to be connected to the purpose of the organization. With an awkward smile on his face, Ronan told Karaka that he has not gotten far in the interrogations. Immediately Ronan said this, he noticed that Karaka had a menacing look on his face. Ronan was terrified to see this look. Ronan was surprised by the change in the atmosphere around Karaka. Karaka put his mask on his head and told Ronan that he understands what he means. He opens the gate of the cell and tells Ronan that he has shown him a poor side on their first meeting. With a horrifying look on his face, he told Ronan that he is very embarrassed with himself. He told Ronan that his heart seems to have not reached his friends. He told Ronan that he has to show his friends more sincerity. Ronan was shocked to see what was inside the cell. He could not believe that the arrogant and proud criminals were reduced to such a terrible state. Karaka told them that Edwin is an interesting friend of his. He said that Edwin keeps on regenerating his body with a unique black magic. He picked up a torture device and told them that the best way to get close to Edwin is to keep on poking at him until he can no longer regenerate. He stabbed Edwin and told them that this is the result he achieved from putting all his heart into cutting Edwin's limbs. He pointed his torture device at Ronan and Nabirose and told them that he and Edwin have become close. With a horrifying look in his eyes, he told Edwin that he thought that they were close. He told Edwin that he is disappointed in him for hiding things from him. He grabbed Edwin's hair and told him that they should open their hearts to each other. Edwin was terrified to hear this. He began to cry. He told Karaka that he has already told him every single thing. Karaka asked him about why Ronan is telling him something about the arrival of the star. Edwin became hesitant when he heard this. Upon seeing how Edwin was hesitant to tell him anything, Karaka told Edwin that he hopes he can get an answer from him. He revealed to Edwin that Cirilla does not have any regenerative ability, so it will be easy to torture her. Cirilla began to tremble when she heard Karaka. Karaka told Edwin that Cirilla will die if she receives any more pain. Cirilla begged Karaka to kill her. Ronan was surprised to see what was happening. He had never seen something as brutal as this even in his military days. While Edwin was trembling from the hot torture device that was about to burn his face, Ronan wondered if it really made any sense that Edwin would take such sufferings just to keep his organization's secrets. It did not make sense to Ronan that Edwin was still hiding any secret after his identity has been revealed. He told Karaka that Edwin might not be refusing to talk. Instead, he is unable to talk. Nabirose was surprised to hear this. Ronan told her that it is occasionally done to a soldier that controls secrets while they are on the battlefield. Magicians cast a sealing curse magic on soldiers so that they do not disclose any content to the enemy. Karaka let Edwin go when he heard this. He told Ronan that he is embarrassed about a lot of things. He could not believe that he missed something as important as that. He told Ronan and Nabirose that he needs to get something important. A few minutes later, Karaka brought a mysterious creature. He told Ronan and Nabirose that the creature is called Kiss Eye. It is a creature that eats curses. He told them that the Kiss Eye is useful when interrogating a criminal who is speechless due to various curses. He walked up to Edwin and placed the Kiss Eye on his head. The Kiss Eye got into Edwin's skin and began to glow. While it was glowing, Edwin was screaming in pain. After the Kiss Eye was done eating the curse placed on Edwin, smoke came out of Edwin's body. Karaka walked up to Edwin and asked him about the arrival of the star. Edwin knew that Karaka was going to torture him if he did not answer. He was terrified by this idea. He decided to answer Karaka. He told Karaka that the star is an eternal being. It is the sole blessing that will save the weak beings of the Empire. Edwin said that Nebula Clagier is a torch that is waiting for the arrival of the star that will begin beyond the sky. Cirilla was shocked to hear what Edwin said. Edwin said that it is the organization's lifelong wish to remove everything that will disturb that day. Cirilla screamed at Edwin. She told him to shut his mouth. Karaka told Edwin that what he is saying is too long. He asked Edwin about what is going to fall from the sky. With a deadly glare in his eyes, Edwin told Karaka that the children of the stars are the ones coming. Ronan was annoyed to hear this. He realized that Edwin was referring to Ahiyuti. Ronan walked up to Edwin. With a terrifying look on his face, he asked Edwin if the children of the stars which he is talking about is called Ahiyuti. Edwin was shocked to hear this. He could not understand how Ronan knew something about the Children of the Stars. He asked Ronan about how he knew about Ahiyuti. Before he could ask Ronan another question, his face began to swell. Ronan was shocked to see this. He did not understand what was going on. Karaka placed his hand on Ronan's shoulder and asked Ronan to step back. He activated a spell immediately. Ronan got behind him. A bright light came out of Edgewin's face and his body exploded. The spell which Karaka activated protected Heat and Ronan from the blast. Karaka was surprised to see that Edgewin's body actually exploded. He never expected Edgewin's body to have any issues after the curse was absorbed from him. He was surprised to see that only pieces of flesh remained from Edgewin's body. Ronan asked Karaka if such things usually happen during interrogations. Karaka told him things like this rarely happen. He told Ronan that things hardly ever reach such a point during interrogations. He told Ronan that the curse on Edgewin's body was cast in two parts. The first part is to never reveal anything about the Children of the Stars to someone who is not a member of their organization. Cirilla began to shake when she heard what Karaka said. Karaka told Ronan that the second part is that the members of the organization will explode if they mention words related to the Children of the Stars or the Stars' advent. Karaka placed his hand on Ronan's shoulder and asked him about what Ahiyuti is in a terrifying tone. Ronan was shocked to hear the question. Karaka realized that the word Ronan mentioned is a secret within Nebula Clagier. He asked Ronan about how he was able to know such a confidential information. He activated his magic and told Ronan that he must know everything about the case because he is an interrogator. With a horrifying look on his face, he asked Ronan to tell him what he knows. Ronan became scared when he saw the look on Karaka's face. He told Karaka that he came across the information by coincidence. Karaka asked him to explain himself. Ronan told him that he was the first person to come across Edgewin and Cirilla. He told Karaka that he picked up the word when he eavesdropped on them. He said that he did not think that it was an important word, but he changed his mind after seeing the interrogation. He told Karaka that when he realized that the word was important, he got excited and decided to ask Edgewin about it. He removed Karaka's hand from his shoulder and apologized to him for intervening in his investigation. He asked Karaka if his explanation is good enough for him. Karaka was still skeptical about Ronan. It did not make sense to him that Ronan coincidentally acquired information that was crucial. He was certain that Ronan was still hiding the truth, while he did not trust Ronan. He knew that Ronan was not a danger to the Empire thanks to the look in his eyes. He did not know if Ronan's eyes were displaying strong willpower or responsibility. He soon realized that Ronan's eyes were not displaying any of these things. Instead, it was showing a massive amount of anger towards Nebula Clagier. Karaka was surprised to see such a large amount of resentment. While Karaka was lost in Ronan's eyes, Navy Rose unsheathed her sword and put it near Karaka's neck. She asked him to stop his nonsense. With a look of anger in her face, he asked Karaka if he is actually thinking of questioning her disciple in front of her. Karaka panicked when he heard this. He let Ronan go and told the unprecedented sword saint that he simply wants to double check. He told her that it is good to be careful. He politely apologized to Ronan for the inconvenience he caused him. Ronan told him to not worry about it. He told Karaka that they were able to clear up the misunderstanding. Ronan was happy that Nebirose intervened. He was terrified of being interrogated by Karaka. Karaka said that he feels bad about losing the cursed eye that died along with Edgewin. He said that cursed eyes are creatures that are very hard to kill, unlike most fantastical creatures. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He asked Karaka if cursed eyes are powerful. Karaka told him that they are very powerful creatures. He asked Ronan if he wants to touch the cursed eye. He looked at the cursed eye and noticed something odd. The cursed eye was glowing. Karaka did not understand what was going on. He did not know when the cursed eye absorbed the curse. He was certain that the cursed eye did not go anywhere near Cirilla. He realized that the cursed eye absorbed the curse from Ronan. He remembered that he touched Ronan when he wanted to use his mana shield. He was surprised that the cursed eye was able to absorb a curse from Ronan in such a brief moment. He grabbed Ronan's hand and apologized for his rude behavior. He placed the cursed eye on Ronan's hand. Ronan was shocked to see this. He asked Karaka about what he is doing. The cursed eye began to absorb the curse from Ronan's body. Unfortunately for the creature, the curse in Ronan was too much for it to handle. The cursed eye exploded. Ronan did not understand what was going on. He asked Karaka about why the cursed eye would explode on its own. Karaka was surprised that the cursed eye was not able to handle the curse. He told Ronan to not be shocked about what he wants to tell him. He told Ronan that he is cursed. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He asked Karaka to explain himself. Karaka asked Ronan if he has ever felt any restrictions in his day-to-day movements. He asked Ronan if he cannot do things like running or holding an object that was made out of steel. He asked Ronan if there is something that others can do but he cannot. Ronan realized that he has never felt a mana circulation in his body. He and Nabiroz realized that this might be caused by his curse. When Karaka saw the look in Ronan's eyes, he realized that he was right. He told Ronan that he won't ask him anything about it if he does not want to talk about it. He told Ronan that he also does not have a solution to his problem. With a horrifying look on his face, he told Ronan that he does not know who cast the curse on him, but the curse contains an enormous amount of ill intent. After the interrogation ended, Karaka escorted Nabiroz and Ronan to their carriage. He told them that he will inform them about Cirilla's interrogations as soon as he lifts her curse. He told them that the interrogations will take a while because the curse is very strong. Nabiroz told him that she understands. She told him to report anything he finds to her. Karaka noticed that Ronan was quiet. He realized that Ronan was lost in his thoughts. He asked Ronan if he has a lot on his mind. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He told Karaka that he is a little shocked to find out that he has a curse on him. Karaka told Ronan that he should not worry about it too much. He reminded Ronan that he is a Filion Academy student. Ronan was shocked to hear this. He did not understand how such an information was going to help him. He asked Karaka to explain what he means. With a smile on his face, Karaka told Ronan that there is someone who has been in the academy for a long time. This person is the only mage on the continent who knows a lot about curses. This person is Professor Maya's secret. The scene shifts and we see Ronan and Nabiroz in their flying carriage. Ronan was itching his eye in the carriage. He did not understand why his eyes and body was feeling uncomfortable. Nabiroz asked him if he is feeling weird. She asked him if his eyes are extremely itchy. Ronan told her that his eyes have been itchy ever since the cursed eye drained some of the curse out of him. He asked her if there is something wrong with his eyes. Nabiroz told him not to worry about it. She told him that what he is experiencing is a sign that his curse is weakening. She asked Ronan if he truly does not know anything about the person who placed a curse on him. Ronan told her that he does not know anyone capable of placing a curse on him. He told her that he does not know someone who harbors evil intentions against him. He told her that he lived a kind life, of course. This sentence did not make sense because Ronan had beaten and killed a large amount of people ever since he returned to the past. He proudly told Nabiroz that he is someone who is kind enough to not give anyone a reason to hold a grudge against him. He thanked Nabiroz for not allowing Karaka to interrogate him. He told her that Karaka's eyes were terrifying and brutal. He told her that if she had not stepped up, he would have confessed to a crime that he did not even commit. Nabiroz told Ronan not to thank her. She told him that she was simply fulfilling her duties as an instructor. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He realized that Nabiroz was not simply skilled, but she also had a good personality. He became certain that she is a good person, while Ronan was certain that Nabiroz was an amazing person. He realized that something about her did not add up. He found it strange that an instructor as powerful as Nabiroz did not participate in the war in his previous life. He realized that Nabula Clagier might have done something to Nabiroz and the powerful instructors of the academy. The scene shifts and we see that Ronan has returned back to the academy. He went to the dedicated practice space for the magic department. This space is in a place called Sherry Forest. At the entrance of the forest is a place called the Park of Pillars. Ade Shan came to welcome Ronan to the forest. She told him that it has been a long time since she met him. With a bright smile on her face, she told him that she was able to meet him thanks to Nabiroz's orders. She asked Ronan if he has been doing well. Ronan was shocked to see Ade Shan. He had completely forgotten about her and her request. He did not know how to respond to her. Ade Shan did not understand why Ronan had such an odd expression on his face. Ronan had forgotten about Ade Shan thanks to the problems related to Nebula Clagier. He was still getting his thoughts together, so Ade Shan did not come to his mind. He decided to awkwardly smile in order to not make their encounter weird. He greeted her and asked her if she has been doing well. Ade Shan told him that ever since the day he went on a rampage, the students who were wary of Cardan have become comfortable when they approach her. She told Ronan that she is a bit worried about Cardan because he gets scared every time he sees her. Ronan became worried when he heard this. Ade Shan told Ronan that instructor Nabiroz told her that he wants to break a curse. Ronan told her that he came to meet Professor Secret. He told Ade Shan that he is a bit worried that he has to pass such a dark and eerie place all because he wants to meet her. Ade Shan told him that Professor Secret's office is very unique and no one is able to find it unless they are magic students. She revealed to Ronan that they will be meeting a junior magic student who is her friend. Immediately she said this, we see a mysterious person appear at Adeshan's front. The person immediately hugged Ade Shan. The person turned out to be Erzabet. Erzabet called Adesh on elder sister and told her that she missed her a lot. Adesh on called Erzabet airy. Ronan was shocked to see this. He remembered Erzabet as a proud girl who was talking about beasts and sheep. Adesh on apologized to Erzabet for disturbing her. She told Erzabet that something urgent came up. With a look of love and obsession on her face, Erzabet told Adesh on to not worry about it. She told Adesh on to call her anytime she wants to. Erzabet asked Adesh on about why she wants to see Professor Secret. Immediately she asked this question. She noticed that Ronan was standing next to Adesh on. Ronan did not know what to say to her. She was extremely shocked to see Ronan. She did not know what to say. She could only look at him weirdly. After regaining his confidence, Ronan greeted her and even called her by her nickname. Erzabet was surprised to hear this. She screamed out in anger. She could not believe that Ronan was actually standing before her. The scene shifts and we see Erzabet guiding Ronan through the forest. When they finally arrived at the professor's office, Ronan was shocked. He could not believe that the professor would be staying in a cottage in the woods. Ronan did not believe that a professor's office would be in the woods. He called Erzabet airy and asked her if she plans to bury him in the woods because he saw her behave in an embarrassing manner. Erzabet screamed at him when she heard her nickname. She told him that he is not allowed to call her such a name. She told him to shut up and follow her. Ronan was surprised to see the relationship between Adesh on and Erzabet. Of course, their relationship did not seem abnormal because Adesh on was also a member of the Akalushia family in her previous life. Erzabet opened the door of the cottage. When Ronan stepped inside, he saw an old woman. He asked Erzabet if the old woman is Professor Secret. Erzabet told Ronan to not jump into conclusions. She told him that there is still one more stage left. Ronan did not understand what she meant. Erzabet and Ronan walked up to the old woman. Erzabet raised her hand up and a purple light came out of it. She told Ronan to not interfere in what is about to happen. Ronan was worried to hear this, but he accepted her request. Erzabet called out a magical spell and asked something to open. Nothing happened when Erzabet casted the spell. Ronan did not understand what was going on. He asked Erzabet about why nothing happened. Immediately he said this, the old woman's mouth began to enlarge. The woman's head looked like that of a titan, and she was about to swallow the students. Ronan was terrified to see this. He asked Erzabet about what he was looking at. Erzabet told him to keep calm and follow her lead. Immediately the old lady swallowed them. They appeared in a study. Erzabet welcomed Ronan to the office of Professor Secret. The office is called Seferakio. Ronan was shocked to see how large the real office was. He did not understand why the professor would have such an odd entrance to her office. While he was looking around, he hears a woman call him. The woman who was floating in midair at the back of Ronan asked him if he is the disciple Nabiro's promised to send. Ronan was surprised to hear the voice. He wanted to turn around to see who was talking, but Professor Secret suddenly appeared in his front. She took a look at his eyes and realized that Nabiro's was telling the truth. Ronan was extremely shocked to see her. She told Ronan that his curse is quite vicious. This woman is the best curse magic user on the continent. The shocking thing about her is that she is 83 years old. With a smile on her face, Professor Secret told Ronan that he is quite interesting. Ronan was surprised to see Professor Secret. He could not believe that the little girl floating in front of him was actually a professor. When Professor Secret saw how Ronan looked at her, she told Ronan to not be shocked with her appearance. She told Ronan that she has a young body due to some circumstances. She revealed to Ronan that she is actually over 80 years old. Ronan was shocked to hear this. He believed that she was an 8-year-old girl when he saw her. He asked her about how she is able to have such a young appearance despite being 80. Professor Secret told Ronan that she will discuss the details with him later. She told him to focus on his current problem. Immediately she said this, she snapped her fingers and a magic circle appeared under Ronan's feet. Ronan's body produced different ribbons that had mysterious writings on them. Ronan was shocked to see the magical ribbons. He asked Professor Secret about what they were. Sergit was surprised to see so many magical ribbons which were curses. She could not believe that Ronan's body was housing so many curses, including ancient curses which are close to their root of origin. She told Ronan that anybody with average skills won't be able to even dream about touching his curses. Ronan became scared when he heard this. He asked Professor Secret if it is still possible for him to remove the curses. Professor Secret asked Ronan to stop worrying. She told him that the curses are more than she expected, but she can still handle them. Immediately she said this, the magic circle under Ronan's feet began to glow. She told Ronan that she will materialize the curses in his body in an imaginary world within his consciousness. She told Ronan that he only has to do one thing. She asked him to find the root of the curse that binds him and cut it down. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He could not believe that Professor Secret wanted him to cut down a curse. He grabbed the curses that were on his body and asked Professor Secret about how he will be able to identify what he needs to cut. Professor Secret smiled and told Ronan not to worry about it. She told him that he will recognize the curse the moment he comes across it. Immediately she said this, she moved close to Ronan and touched his head. A bright light came out of her hand and Ronan fell into an unknown abyss. When he woke up, he found himself in his imaginary world. When Ronan turned around to look at his surroundings, he saw something shocking. He saw his house. He did not understand what his house was doing in his imaginary world. He wondered if the root of his curse was inside his house. While staring at his house, a young girl passed by his side. The girl told her mother that she is back. Ronan was shocked to hear the girl's voice. He was certain that this voice belonged to his elder sister. The younger version of Iroh ran into the house to see her baby brother in his cradle. She was surprised by how cute Ronan was. She turned around and asked her mother about why her little brother is always sleeping. She asked her mother if Ronan is sick. With a bright smile on their mother's face, she told Iroh that babies need a lot of sleep to grow up well. She told Iroh that if Ronan becomes sick later, she will have to take care of him as his older sister. Iroh was happy to hear this. She told her mother that she will protect her little brother forever. Ronan was in shock to see what was happening in front of him. He was certain that this is something that happened back when he had just been born. He could not believe that the baby in the cradle was actually him. Ronan could not believe that he was actually a baby at some point. He always believed that he had grown up from the moment he was born. Ronan could not believe that he was actually looking at his past self. The entire situation did not make sense to him. While he was looking at the cradle, a man with a dark and ominous aura stepped into the house. Ronan was terrified when he felt the man's energy. He noticed that his body could not move at all. He became curious about the man's identity. Iroh and her mother welcomed the man with a smile on their faces. Ronan was able to hear what his mother and Iroh said, but he could not hear anything the man said. The man told Ronan's mother that he wants to see Ronan. Ronan's mother was happy to hear this. She believed that the man must have been curious about Ronan's face. Ronan's mother told the man that Ronan looks just like him. The man raised his hand, which contained a mysterious energy, and said some words to Ronan's mother. Immediately he said this, he used his mysterious power on her. Immediately he did this. Ronan's mother fell down and lost consciousness. Iroh was surprised to see this. Ronan was shocked to see what was happening. While Iroh was crying for her mother, the man moved close to her and used his powers on her. Iroh also lost consciousness. Ronan was extremely shocked to see this. He called out for his sister in anger. He did not understand why the mysterious man was harming his family. While looking at his sister, Ronan noticed something odd. He saw the man standing next to his cradle with the curses on his hand. The man placed the curse into Ronan's body and a bright light shined from Ronan's cradle. Ronan became certain that the man must be the root of the curse. He decided that he must cut the man down. The scene shifts and we see Professor Secret and Erzabeth looking at Ronan's body. Professor Secret was surprised to see how powerful Ronan's curse was. She could not believe that it was able to drain her mana even after she prepared for it. Erzabeth was shocked to hear this. She could not believe that even the almighty Professor Secret believed that a curse was too strong. She asked her professor about the amount of curses that are in Ronan's body. Professor Secret told Erzabeth that there are roughly 10 curses in Ronan's body. Erzabeth was shocked to hear this. She told Professor Secret that her mana must have been drained because she is dealing with 10 curses. Professor Secret told Erzabeth that she is wrong. With a serious look on her face, she told Erzabeth that she is currently dealing with one curse. The scene shifts and we are taken back to Ronan. After the mysterious man placed the curse in Ronan's body, the man said some words to him and turned around. He walked past Iroh and her mother. Ronan was annoyed to see this after the man left the house. Ronan regained his strength. He quickly ran to check on his mother and his elder sister. He called out their names, but no one answered him. After calming down, he realized that Iroh and his mother were simply at sleep. He placed his hand on his head and did his best to relax. He believed that there is only one thing to do in this imaginary world, and that is to kill the mysterious man. He cut his door into pieces and ran outside with a look of anger on his face. When he got outside, he noticed something odd. He saw the mysterious man standing outside the house. He asked the man if he was waiting for him. With a serious look on his face, Ronan asked the man if he has any business with him. The man did not respond to Ronan. This made Ronan much more angry. He could not believe that the man actually hurt his family in front of him. He told the man that he will never forgive him. Immediately he said this, he unsheathed his sword and rushed to attack the man. As Ronan moved closer to the man activated his mysterious power. He used his ability to create a sword which he used to block Ronan's attack. Ronan was shocked to see that the man was able to block his attack. He began to attack the man with more energy. Unfortunately for Ronan, the man blocked each one of his attacks. Ronan did not understand what was going on. He could not believe that a mere curse was able to wield a sword. He was more surprised by the fact that the curse was actually beating him. The man used his sword to cut Ronan in different places. After seeing that Ronan was getting weaker, the man used his sword to launch an attack that severely damaged Ronan. Ronan fell to the ground when he received the attack. Ronan could not believe what was happening to him. His sword was not able to even touch the man's skin. Due to the fact that the man did not attack him while he was down, Ronan deduced that the man must not be able to kill him. He realized that the man was asking him to leave the imaginary world. Ronan was annoyed when he understood the man's intentions. He did not want the fight to end in such a horrible manner because he still had a lot of questions to ask the man. He pulled his strength together and tried to get up. After successfully pushing himself up, he screamed at the man. He told the man that he is not yet done with him. Ronan asked the man about why he treated his family in such a horrible way. He told the man that his mother and his sister don't usually show affections to anyone. He told the man that Iroh only has such an expression for people she loves. With a look of anger on his face, he called the man a bastard. He deduces that the man must be his father. He asked his father about why he did such a thing to their family. Ronan's father did not respond to Ronan's question. Ronan became annoyed when his father did not respond to him. A red energy began to cover his body. He could not believe that his father was not trying to explain or make any excuses after he treated his family in such a way and placed a curse on Ronan. Ronan closed the gap between him and his father. He placed the red energy into his sword and used it to cut his father's head off. The head began to slowly fade away after it was cut off. Ronan walked up to the head. Ronan used his sword to stab the head before it could fade away completely. He told his father that he will figure out everything by himself, with a menacing look on his face. He told his father to stay out of his body. After his father's body disappeared, Ronan got transported back to reality. He quickly realized that he was in Sephirakio. Professor Secret came to greet Ronan immediately he woke up. She asked him about how he is feeling. Ronan was shocked to see Professor Secret. He asked her about who she was. After staring for a while, Ronan realized that the old woman standing in front of him is Professor Secret. Ronan did not understand what happened to her. He asked her about how she became old in the short time he left her. He asked her if she is growing old because of him. Professor Secret smiled when she heard Ronan's questions. She told him that her current situation is not his fault. She asked Ronan if he feels anything different now. Ronan already knew that Professor Secret was an unusual person, but now that he is able to see her mana, he realized that she was more outstanding than he expected. When Professor Secret saw that Ronan was able to see her mana, she realized that her plan worked. Professor Secret and Ronan sat down to discuss about what happened in Ronan's imaginary world. Professor Secret was surprised to hear Ronan's experience. She could not believe that the curse in Ronan was based on an old memory which even Ronan did not know about. She was more surprised to find out that the man who placed a curse on Ronan was his father. Professor Secret asked Ronan about how he knew the man was his father when his appearance was blurry. Ronan told her that he could tell by how his mother and his sister behaved towards the man. More importantly, Ronan felt something odd when the man placed his hands on his family. This feeling was something Ronan had never felt in his life. This feeling was an unfamiliar sorrow. Ronan realized that he became more angry and riled up thanks to this feeling. Ronan wondered if he was feeling the same emotions as the man. Professor Secret asked Ronan if he does not have any memories of his parents. Ronan told her that he does not. What was more odd was the fact that he and his sister had never wondered about why they could not remember their parents. It was as if the memories of their parents was erased from their heads. Professor Secret was shocked to hear this. She realized that Ronan's awareness of his existence was sealed alongside his ability to perceive mana. She told Ronan that his father put a curse on him and messed with his memories as well. In the process of placing the curse, some of his father's memories got transferred to him. She revealed to Ronan that magic spells related to memories occasionally have similar side effects. She told Ronan that his imaginary world was naturally materialized with his memories. She told Ronan that the fact that he could use mana to kill the curse is because it became possible for him to perceive mana, which was a reaction to recovering his disconnected cognition. Upon hearing Professor Secret's explanation, Ronan realized that the shiny strands that he is currently seeing is mana. Professor Secret told him that he is only able to see mana right now, but very soon, he will be able to manipulate it like other students. Of course, this is only possible if Ronan is able to release two more curses among the 9 remaining curses cast upon him. Professor Secret told Ronan that it will take some time to remove his curses because all the curses placed on him are of unknown origin and are very powerful. She told Ronan that she will inform him once she is ready to break the curses. She told Ronan to return to his dorm because he has spent an entire day in her office and a new day has begun. Ronan noticed something odd when Professor Secret asked him to leave. Professor Secret had returned back to her youth. Ronan was extremely shocked to see this. He asked Professor Secret if her appearance changes depending on the time of the day. Professor Secret told Ronan that her body also has its own complicated circumstances. Professor Secret knew that the event Ronan witnessed in his imaginary world are a lot for a normal student to bear. She told Ronan to take care of his mind. She advises him to not be tied down by his past because he has more precious days ahead. Ronan was happy to hear Professor Secret's advice. He stood up and gave a bow to his professor. He told her that he will be in her care. The scene shifts and we see a man standing next to the crystal giant underneath the Grand Cappadoki. The man was surprised to see how huge the crystal giant was. He could not believe that a student was able to stop the giant on his own. While the man was staring at the giant, his subordinate, whose name is Dolan, came to greet the man. The man asked Dolan if the restoration of the forge is going well. Dolan told the man that everything is going well. He assured the man that the forge will be operating in a week. Dolan told the man that he was not able to find any additional information about Cirilla and Edwin. He told the man that he was able to find Ronan's location through the academy. This man is Joseph Sinivan de Grancia. He is the head of the Grancia Duchy and a Duke of the Empire. While Joseph was talking to Dolan, the crystal giant came to life. The giant raised its hand and was ready to crush the two men. When Joseph noticed this, he asked his boss to move aside. He placed his hand on his sword and told the Duke that he will bring the night troop to fight the giant. Joseph told Dolan to not bother himself. He told Dolan that the knights will be busy. Due to the fact that the two men did not make a move, the giant decided to crush them with its fist. The moment its hand got close to the men, Joseph unsheathed his sword and used his aura to cut the giant into pieces. When he was done, he put his sword back and asked Dolan to follow him. With a smile on his face, Joseph told Dolan that they are going to meet the young hero of Philion Academy. At Ronan's hostel, someone knocks on his door very early in the morning. Ronan could not believe that someone came to visit him so early in the morning. When Ronan opened the door, he sees Dolan standing outside. He asked Dolan for his identity. Ronan assumed that Dolan was a salesman. Dolan was annoyed to hear this. He called Ronan a rude bastard. He believed that Ronan was acting arrogant towards him despite knowing who he was due to the way he was dressed. Ronan guessed that Dolan was an official of a noble family. He was not completely certain about Dolan's identity due to how dark Dolan's mana was. Ronan notices that there was something else mixed with Dolan's mana. Ronan did not know what he was looking at, but he was certain that he recognized this thing. While Dolan was staring at Ronan, the Duke comes to warn him. He told Dolan that it is their fault for visiting Ronan without notifying him. Dolan called Joseph Duke and apologized for his behavior. Ronan was surprised to hear that he was in the presence of the Duke. Joseph apologized to Ronan for Dolan's behavior. With a smile on his face, he asked Ronan if he could spare him some of his time. The Duke stepped into Ronan's room and gave him a box. The box contained a sheath for Ronan's sword. Ronan was surprised to see this. He asked the Duke about why he brought the sheath himself. Joseph told Ronan that the blacksmiths and Doron begged him to bring it. Joseph thanked Ronan for saving the Grand Cappadoki. He told Ronan that the House of Grancia and the Grand Cappadoki have been comrades for a long time. He told Ronan that his sword, whose name is Fail Lord, was created by Doron. Joseph put his hand into his jacket and brought out something. He told Ronan that he wants to give it to him as a gift. Ronan was extremely shocked to see what Joseph wanted to give him. Joseph gave Ronan the Grancia Crest of Proof, which has the seal of the family head. Ronan could not believe that Joseph wanted to give him something so precious. This Crest of Proof can buy 3 villages. Joseph told Ronan that he has to treat their savior well so that the honor of the Grancia lives. He told Ronan that his men have also delivered the blacksmith's gifts and Crest of Proof to both Maria and Asel. Ronan could already imagine how Asel and Maria would be behaving right now. After giving Ronan his gift, Joseph asked Ronan to tell him everything about the person behind the incident. With a serious look on his face, Joseph told Ronan that he is very interested in knowing Edwin and Cirilla. Immediately Joseph said this. Ronan saw a very bright light. Ronan was shocked to see the horrifying mana of the Duke who leads the Grancia family. Ronan told Joseph that Cirilla and Edwin are crazy bastards. Dolan was annoyed to hear this. Ronan told Joseph that Cirilla and Edwin are fast and very annoying. While he was talking, Ronan noticed an odd energy in the air. When he looked up, he noticed that Dolan was the one releasing this energy. Ronan was surprised to see this because Dolan had not moved an inch since he stepped into his room, but he started making a reaction the moment Ronan talked about Edwin and Cirilla. While thinking, Ronan realized that Dolan gives off the same dirty feeling as Edwin and Cirilla. The Duke asked Ronan about what was wrong with him. He asked Ronan about why he stopped talking. Ronan was surprised to hear this question. He did not understand why the Duke was not talking about the mana which Dolan is exuding. The Duke asked Ronan if he is feeling uncomfortable. Ronan was shocked to hear this question. He knew that Duke Grancia is highly renowned as a strong person in the continent, and yet he was not able to see the mana. Ronan quickly realized that he is the only person that can see this unique mana. He asked the Duke if he has heard about the arrival of the stars. Immediately Ronan asked this question, Dolan's expression changed. Upon seeing Dolan's expression, Ronan decided to throw a bait at Dolan. He told the Duke about Nebula Clagier and their purpose. The Duke was very shocked to hear this. He could not believe that such an organization exists on the continent. Joseph asked Ronan if he obtained all the information by himself. Ronan told Joseph that Cirilla and Edwin spilled the truth after he cut off their limbs. With a devious look on his face, Ronan told Joseph that he enjoyed seeing Edwin and Cirilla beg for their lives. Ronan wanted to say more, but the Duke stopped him. He told Ronan that he will confirm the rest of the information from the official document of Rodolin Prison. He told Ronan that he cannot hear more about the incident because he will lose his appetite. Ronan accepted the Duke's wish. After talking to the Duke, Ronan confirmed his suspicion about Dolan. Ronan realized that Dolan has not been able to control himself at all. Ronan could not believe that the Nebula Clagier was hiding even among the Grancia family. He realized that he needed an emergency measure. Joseph told Ronan that he wants to leave. Before Joseph left, Ronan told him that there is something important that he needs to know about Nebula Clagier. Joseph asked Ronan to tell him. Ronan smiled and told Joseph that it will take a long time for him to explain. He told Joseph that he will organize it in the night and send it to him by mail. He assured Joseph that he will be really amused with the package. With a devious smile on his face, Ronan told Joseph that the package will be interesting, especially because it talks about Ahiyuti. Dolan was shocked to hear this. Later in the night, we see Ronan sleeping. Dolan breaks into Ronan's room and tries to assassinate Ronan. When Dolan hit Ronan's neck with his sword, he noticed that he hit some rocks instead of Ronan's neck. He was surprised to see that Ronan was not on the bed. Ronan was on the ceiling of his room. He called Dolan Rat Bastard Number 3 and welcomed him to his room. Dolan was surprised to see that Ronan expected him to come. He turned around and asked Ronan about how he knew about his intentions. Ronan jumped down from the ceiling and told Dolan to turn around. When Dolan turned, he sees someone watching them. Ronan told Dolan that this person is a special guest he invited just for him. Dolan was extremely shocked to see this person. The person turns out to be Dolan's young master Shelafin, with a horrifying look on his face. Shelafin told Dolan to explain the situation to him. A few hours earlier, Ronan went to visit Shelafin in his room. Shelafin was surprised to see Ronan. He never expected Ronan to visit him on his own. He was more surprised to find out that Ronan wanted to ambush Dolan in the night. He believed that Ronan was crazy for suspecting Dolan. He asked Ronan if he has any proof to back up his actions. He told Ronan that Dolan is a knight that possesses great skill and loyalty. He told Ronan that Dolan's loyalty to the Grancia family is quite high among the knight. Shelafin told Ronan that Dolan was chosen as his father's bodyguard after he served their family for 4 years. Ronan was surprised to hear this. He could not believe that Dolan became a bodyguard for the Duke after only serving for 4 years. He believed that 4 years was too short for a knight to serve. He told Shelafin that his family is probably already filled with spies. Shelafin was shocked to hear this. He did not understand what Ronan was talking about. Ronan told him to not bother himself. He told Shelafin that it is not important for him to find out who Dolan is working for. He asked Shelafin to come to his room later in the night. He told Shelafin that he will be saving his family if what he is saying is true. The scene shifts and we are taken back to Ronan's room. Shelafin brought out his sword and pointed it at Dolan. He asked Dolan to explain himself. Dolan was shocked to see this. He did not understand why his young master was in Ronan's room. Ronan laughed at Shelafin when he heard what he said. He told Shelafin that Dolan is not going to answer him just because he asked. He told Shelafin that he is very naive. Ronan believed that Shelafin will not survive in the harsh world if he continues to be nice. Dolan raised his leg up and hit it on the ground. The moment Dolan's leg touched the ground, his body began to release a large amount of mana. Ronan and Shelafin were shocked to see this. Ronan was surprised to see that his body suddenly became heavy. He could not believe that Dolan was using his aura to make his body heavy. While Ronan was thinking about his body, Dolan rushed to attack him. Ronan was able to block the attack with his sword, but he got pushed back. Dolan used his aura to completely suppress Ronan. Shelafin became angry when he saw this. He asked Dolan to give him a reason for his action. Dolan did not answer Shelafin. Instead, he rushed to attack him. The moment his sword touched Shelafin's sword, Dolan told Shelafin that he is too naive. Dolan was relieved that Shelafin was inexperienced in controlling the range of his aura. He knew that Shelafin would not use his powerful technique in a place where other people could easily get swept up in his technique. Shelafin could not still believe that his faithful knight would turn on him. He was very annoyed with the situation. Dolan attacked Shelafin and told him that he is sorry, while pressing Shelafin down with his aura. Dolan told Shelafin that he did not want things to end badly between them. He told Shelafin that his plans got ruined by Ronan. Shelafin was surprised to see the skills which Dolan possessed. He told Dolan that his current skills are different from the ones he is familiar with. He could not believe that Dolan has been hiding his powers for years. He asked Dolan about when he betrayed the family. Dolan was annoyed to hear this. He used his sword to push Shelafin away. With a deadly look in his eyes, Dolan told Shelafin that he was never a knight of the Grancia family. Immediately he said this, he rushed to attack Shelafin. Shelafin was shocked to hear what Dolan said. Upon seeing that Dolan was a spy, Shelafin asked Ronan to do whatever he wants. Immediately he said this, Ronan blocked Dolan's attack. Dolan was shocked to see Ronan. He did not understand how Ronan was still able to move. Ronan ignored Dolan. He called Shelafin a frustrating brat. He could not believe that Shelafin made him struggle all because he wanted to hear Dolan call himself a spy. He asked Shelafin if he is happy with the answer he got. Shelafin told Ronan that the situation was quite serious for him. He begged Ronan to understand his situation. Shelafin picked up his sword and attacked Dolan, with a horrifying look in his eyes. Shelafin told Ronan that a bloodbath will happen in the Grancia family after he is done with Dolan. Shelafin closed the gap between himself and Dolan. Dolan was surprised to see this. He was certain that Shelafin was encroached in his aura. He did not understand how Shelafin was still able to move freely. He was more surprised to see that Shelafin was able to use his heavy sword by simply using mana. Shelafin covered his sword with mana and used it to attack Dolan. Dolan did not understand what was going on. He wondered if Shelafin has been hiding his skills just like him. This did not make sense to him because Shelafin had no reason to hide his skill. Dolan quickly realized that Shelafin adapted to his aura while they were fighting. He knew that Shelafin was a genius that appears once every century, but he never expected Shelafin to be so talented. While Dolan was distracted by Shelafin, Ronan launched a surprise attack on him. He told Dolan to not be relaxed. He told Dolan to not be distracted in a fight. Dolan was surprised to see Ronan. He did not understand how Ronan was able to get close to him. Ronan began to attack Dolan aggressively. Dolan was able to block the attacks, but he was slowly getting overwhelmed by Ronan. Dolan could not believe that Ronan was able to push him back. He realized that Ronan was another talented monster that is as strong as Shelafin. Ronan used his sword to create a large attack. Unfortunately for him, Dolan dodged the attack. Ronan was surprised to see this. He never expected Dolan to be able to dodge such an attack. The moment Dolan dodged the attack, he used his leg to kick Ronan away from him. Dolan realized that their fight has caused a lot of noise. He knew that the professors will soon be coming to check Ronan's room. He realized that he needed to escape. He broke through Ronan's window and landed on the ground. The moment he landed on the ground, he began to run at full speed. Dolan could not believe that things would become so complicated all because he tried to kill Ronan. He realized that he was foolish for thinking that Ronan subdued Edwin and Cirilla with luck. He decided to hide and wait for an opportunity to catch Ronan. While Dolan was running, Shelafin appeared at his back with a sword in his hand. Dolan was terrified to feel Shelafin's presence. Shelafin told Dolan that he cannot control his storm sword like his father. Dolan was shocked to see Shelafin in the air. Shelafin told Dolan that he is stupid for running away after knowing how powerful the storm sword is. A large amount of wind began to gather around Shelafin's sword. Shelafin told Dolan that no one will get swept up in his technique now. With a serious look on his face, Shelafin told Dolan that he will punish him for being a traitor to their family. Immediately Shelafin said this, he activated the Grancius secret sword art. The technique Shelafin activated is called the Storm Sword. This technique created a large tornado that moved towards Dolan. Dolan was horrified to see this technique. He tried to slash the tornado, but he did not affect it. When the tornado got close to Dolan, he realized that he could not destroy such an overpowered technique, as the wind tore him apart. Dolan closed his eyes and prayed to the star. After finishing off Dolan, the tornado disappeared. Shelafin looked at Dolan's body and told him that no one in the Grancia family will remember him after today, as Shelafin walked away from Dolan's body. He told Dolan that he is not important because he was never a Grancia. Guys, we have come to the end of our video. If you guys want part 15 of this video, let me know in the comments section. Don't forget to like and smash that subscribe button for more recaps. See you guys later.